2016. I'm your host, Alex Jones. I'll be here live for the next 3 hours. Then Anthony Gucciardi will come in, a fresh fighter in the info war, to anchor the fourth hour. And then I intend to return live in studio this Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m. Central Standard Time. InfoWars Nightly News, 7 o'clock Central tonight. He's here in Austin, flew in late last night. Roger Stone will be in studio with us for an hour and a half today, taking your phone calls, breaking down the 2016 election and where Trump's going next. Trump is now getting hardcore, not just saying he'd call for a criminal investigation if he was elected president, but saying Hillary Clinton needs to go to jail. Trump, Hillary Clinton has to go to jail. We'll be playing that clip coming up in the next segment. He goes on to say she's guilty as hell. Trump also has a message for Obama that we're going to be playing coming up in the next segment. There's a very powerful piece that Paul Joseph Watson did that I want to air, why social justice warriors are so demented. And he hits the nail on the head here, but I'm going to go even further, as Paul Harvey would say, with the rest of the story. Good day. So that's coming up. We also have the editor of Breitbart, Peter Schweizer, wrote a best-selling book about the Clintons. It's being turned into a movie, joining us for 30 minutes in the second hour as well. But I dropped the ball yesterday. It was a powerful broadcast, but I dropped the ball. I didn't really give folks the big data dump in the first hour or get to any of the clips till the third hour. I'm going to do it. I'm going to have a disciplined first hour, or Nico Acosta could come in here and punch me right in the nose. I told him that because they're not the one criticizing me. I really am criticizing myself because I get stuck on certain topics and issues. There is so much to cover. By the way, thank God for the Drudge Report, because now this is finally getting picked up by some newspapers and publications and being debated as people finally look at it. This happened 4 days ago. We found out about it a few days later, wrote a story about it. No one else we know of picked it up. Drudge did yesterday. It's still on drudgereport.com. EU proposes government ID for internet use. EU proposes government ID to use internet. Proposal sparks Mark of the Beast comparisons. Well, it's beyond that. Whether you believe in Mark of the Beast revelations or not, this is to tax the internet, this is to track the internet, this is to control it. And they say in the document, communication from the Commission to the European Parliament, the Council, the European and Economic and Social Committee, and the Committee of the Regions. The Parliament is ceremonial. These four committees make all the decisions and are unelected and dictatorial, who are appointed and who appoint their successor by the original founders of the European Economic Community Agreement that was first a steel deal in the late 1940s after World War II, the Treaty of London. Then in what, 1956 was it, or 57, I cover it in the film Endgame, the Treaty of Rome made the European Economic Community Program, and it was a private board. And without an election in any of these countries, but two, there's 20 plus in the EU now, all these nations were entered into this in the last few decades, piece by piece, by their prime ministers signing on to it. Without an election, without a referendum, the bureaucracy signed on, so they could then graduate to the supranational level of the EU and then finally graduate to the global government level. But world government is an EU New World Order project by every yardstick, and is a Nazi project. I'm not saying it's a Nazi program or a Nazi conspiracy, but the idea was from the Nazis. And at the end of World War II, the West said, great plan, we'll take it. And they did. They bought the whole program and have now foisted it onto us. And this dovetails with the Atlantic Treaty, with the NAU, the North American Union. This is huge. This is so big, and it's finally starting to get out there. Thanks to you, the listeners. Thanks to all of our affiliates. And thanks to DrudgeReport.com. And, of course, Kit Daniels, who wrote the story. Stay with us. Wow. Trump is absolutely taking the gloves off and is now putting brass knuckles on, and is busting the Democratic Party and Republican Party apparatuses up. He is breaking their ribs, breaking their jaws, right now. And it is a beautiful, 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 wondrous, happy thing to see on every single front. You've seen them come out and talk about crooked Hillary and how they're very crooked people and how they're liars and how they're involved in crime. You've seen him call for a criminal investigation or say that he would seek that if elected president. Now, Trump has come out and said Clinton has to go to jail. She's guilty as hell. We're going to play that in a moment. And we've got Obama bumbling around in multiple speeches, unable to even talk about Trump because these arrogant kleptocrats are so shaken by someone who's not intimidated by them and who can circumvent the dinosaur media. This is a very special time to be alive. People say, is Trump for real? What he's doing's for real. What he's doing is irrevocable to the New World Order. It's damaging. You don't put it back in the bottle. You don't put the horses back in the pen. That's why they're panicking. It's why they are doing you-know-what of their little britches. And nationalists are getting elected all over the world. Populists are getting elected all over the world. And the response in Austria is just steal the election and block it. The response in Germany and France is just arrest people en masse that even speak up for nationalism and try to say, don't be out in public with a French or German flag or British flag. They're now in the mainstream news saying, take down the British flag. It's racist. Because they have to end all free speech that's not globalist. That said, they are releasing the equivalent of 21st century brown shirts into the streets to go out and to beat up men, women, and children. There's the New York Times. Crackdowns on free speech rise across a Europe wary of terror. Talk about twisted bull, just like I told you they did. They bring in the 5 million Muslims from radical areas. They give them a green light to go wild. Germans, French, Swedes, and others, very tolerant people, get up and say, we're not going to allow this. And their speech and their assembly is banned. And if you're in a town of 100 with 700 illegals brought in who are raping and robbing, and men get together to go organize and try to tackle people and stop them, when the cops come, when they're robbing your shop, the cops arrest you and will release, this was in the news yesterday, will release the person robbing in the same day twice. They catch him a third time and they move to indict the vigilantes who simply drug the guy out of the store, hogtied him for the police. This is a lawless criminal takeover. And that New York Times headline says it all. Because of fears of terror, after the EU brought these people in, organized the partial fall of Syria as a conduit into Turkey, they brought down Libya, that's a conduit into Italy. They admit that's record numbers, hundreds of thousands every few months coming across, and Italy just lets them land. Just as Gaddafi warned, they made Libya a failed state. They have made Syria a partially failed state, both because one by sea and one by land border Europe as the pincer double-edged attack. And now, Facebook and Twitter say, we're going to censor you if you criticize the migrants, the poor little migrants. Agitators pelt female Trump supporters with eggs, tomatoes in San Jose. They chase a woman down and beat her up, hooping and yelling. It's kind of like pushing the police horse over and it breaks its legs and everybody, you know, celebrates and they kill the horse. It's so wonderful. These are hateful, horrible people attacking a woman while they wave a Mexican flag in her face. As Kurt Nemo wrote for Infowars.com, that's the new culture in America. That's the new system in America, is gangsters waving a Mexican flag, beating a woman up, bloodying her. But don't worry, local news just said, oh, the Trump rally caused a riot. It was Trump's fault. And the mayor came out and said, this is a good thing. And I've got stacks of articles here where they've got the different leftist publications saying this is good, do this everywhere. Go out like a bunch of brown shirts and beat people up. But I love how the folks waving Mexican flags, grown men, some of them looks like 6'4", picked a little woman. By the way, you can put somebody's eye out with an egg. And there they are, hitting her in the face with the egg, slapping her, hitting her. It's so funny to do that to a woman. I mean, where are the men? Because I'm going to tell you right now, I start seeing somebody hit a woman in the face with an egg, I'm going to defend, guaranteed. And so folks are going to get the fight they're looking for. They're going to look for the uppercuts that their jaws and noses were begging for. And hey, who knows, you might beat me up, but you're not going to be able to sit there and pick on a woman while you flap a Mexican flag in her face. And again, can you imagine Americans down in Mexico, in, say, Mexico City, surrounding a woman, hitting her with American flags and hitting her in the face with eggs? But this is all acceptable. This is the Hispanic Ku Klux Klan garbage that our media and our universities push, just like we saw the white Ku Klux Klan in the 50s and 60s doing the same type of crap to black people and their white supporters in the South. But that's not going on today, and I don't have any shared white guilt. I didn't have any part of that. And my grandfather worked to pass the Civil Rights Movement to promote it in East Texas. None of that matters, though, because I'm white. I'm inherently evil. I'm bad. So that white woman deserves to be attacked, too, doesn't she? Because she dared come out and try to be part of the First Amendment. And it goes on and on. Left-wing Vox editor, if Trump comes to your town, start a riot. Trump supporters terrorized in massive San Jose street brawl as police lose control. And there's all raw video of it. The police say that the anti-Trump people started it and did all of it. But it doesn't matter. Media, mainstream media wonders why it's losing all of its support. Our reporters were there, by the way, and witnessed it all. We got to get Biggs on today. No. Doesn't matter. Mainstream media is going to cover it up where a bunch of out-of-control social justice warriors, communist, Hispanic Klan groups, and others go out, and the police stand there and let them do it. Here it is, the de-evolution of politics in America, gangster thugs with Mexican flags. Establishment media insists violent thugs in San Jose are protesters. Very good article by Kurt Nemo. Leftist media, San Jose mayor, justify anti-Trump violence, attacks on women. And we have the clips of the news, and Paul Watson breaks it down. Just unbelievable. Just like in Nazi Germany, the persecution of certain groups started, and it was sold by the media as good. Meanwhile, Mexico is a failed state collapsing, and most Mexicans just want to live in a free country and have a good job and be able to live in freedom. But our universities and our systems, run by the globalists, are breeding this culture of divide and conquer. And it is causing massive, massive retrenchment by whites into classical, what you'd call white tribalism or racism. And the recruitment by the white supremacists and all the other groups is exploding. And that's why the white supremacist groups hate me so much, is because they understand that I'm trying to create a culture of liberty that transcends supposed race so we can actually have a future. They all want their own countries. The blacks want, you know, the black nationalists, the white nationalists, the Hispanic nationalists. And when I say nationalist, I'm for nationalists. They want a race nation. That's different. Just like a prison where you got the white area, the black area, the Hispanic area. That's what they're turning America into. And I oppose that project of balkanization. And that's why I'm hated. And that's why I'm attacked by the leftist Mexican supremacists, the white supremacists, the black supremacists. They just all hate my guts because they're all foundation globalist run. And they're useful idiot morons. But this is really unprecedented. We're going to come back and play some of the footage briefly. There's more and more internet censorship. We're going to cover more of the EU rolls out plan for government ID to be able to use the internet. This is the end of the internet as we know it. We're going to be going over that some more. We're also going to be obviously taking your phone calls. But censorship is intensifying, and everyone, so we can send you videos, articles, you name it, in intense times of censorship or control, we need to be able to contact you via email, infowars.com/newsletter. And we can be able to send you that information out on a daily basis. So again, please take action today. Infowars.com/newsletter. Also, with the allergy season really heating up, with the summertime, and with all the different things that are happening with different infections and things, I personally boost my own immune system with Lung Cleanse. It's 20% off. We only do this a few times a year. It's the time of year for us to have this as a special. Unfortunately, people are, I guess, wait for specials, so it's going to sell out by Monday or Tuesday at current sales rates. We have a limited supply. It'll be a few months till we have any more, unfortunately. So if you want Lung Cleanse that's got close to 20 different organic oils concentrated and other key herbs to really, really just have an amazing effect when nothing else is working and I'm coughing and hacking, and this just absolutely knocks it out. A lot of singers I know use it. A lot of public speakers use it. Lung Cleanse, 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com until it runs out. Stay with us. If you're a radio listener, obviously you can't see the TV portion of this transmission, but you can always go to Infowars.com/show and find the free live video feed. You can also see it on some TV and cable systems around the country. But it really adds a layer to it to see a mob of men waving Mexican flags, hitting a woman in the head with the flags, slapping her, throwing eggs in her face, and then piling on. You can't see what else happens, but then she's later on the news bleeding. And the media calls this, oh, Trump supporters causing a riot. So this is the attack on reality. And yeah, the woman joked around and stuck her butt back out at him when they're going F you and all this other stuff. And they said, oh, we'll just attack you. So this is what the feminists, I guess, want as well, is, you know, to like live in the Middle East and where you stay chained up half the time, or you have to wear a hood over your head when you go out in public. This is the degeneration and the balkanization. This is how you conquer a country if you're a multinational combine of corporations. You come in, you look at every racial and cultural division and religious division, you dissect them, and you have the universities in the name of unity, hype everyone up, give everybody chips on their shoulders, and then descend into bedlam while Hillary Clinton and others sell the nation out. But Trump is striking at the heart of it, is why the media, the establishment propaganda arm, is activating its useful idiots. Because he's coming out and saying Hillary Clinton has to go to jail. She's guilty as hell. Here's the clip.
By the way, Hillary Clinton is missing 30,000 emails. They've been deleted. 30,000. 30,000 emails. And remember I said I was a counterpuncher? I am. After what she said about me today in her phony speech, that was a phony speech. That was a Donald Trump hit job. I will say this. Hillary Clinton has to go to jail, okay? She has to go to jail.
Oh, I love him.
That was a phony hit job. She's guilty as hell. Remember, Hillary Clinton used to hate Obama. She used to hate him. Bill Clinton hated him. Bill Clinton hated him. He called Bill Clinton a racist. Do you remember that? Bill Clinton hated him. And Hillary Clinton hated Obama. Now it's, yes, sir, Mr. President, sir. Yes, sir. What would you like? What would you like me to say here, sir? The only reason she's behaving like this, and the only reason she's been dragged so far left, believe me, is she doesn't want to go to jail over the emails, okay? Believe me. That's the only reason. One simple reason.
Wow, ladies and gentlemen, look, no one's ever fought the globalists for 67 years, 60 to 70 years, because they would just have the media deny it existed while they built the project and while they robbed us and while they set it up. Now, because of real media, they can't lie. They have no power. I mean, almost no power now. Trump's challenging them at a key point, and that's what they can't deal with, is engagement, is resistance, is someone standing up. And he's an example to us. Stand up and see what happens. I've taken the gloves off way beyond what Trump's ever done. And has it destroyed me or has it empowered me? Fortune favors the bold. That's the SAS Special Forces saying. But the fortune I'm looking for isn't some pot of gold. It's liberty and freedom for my children and your children and humanity into the future. And I'm following basic, documented systems that will make not just America great, but the world great in a new renaissance. And I'm out here bragging going, hey, I'm tough. I took the gloves off a long time ago. But comparatively, Trump is on a platform 50 times bigger than I am right now. The world stage, 100 times. And is just blasting them with Death Star level political truth beams that you can't stand up against. Look, you're a crook, lady. You need to go to jail. You're a fraud. Everybody knows it. Here's a bunch of examples. Your foreign policy is a disaster. You're a crook. You're corrupt. And Trump metaphysically knows you don't strike first. You let them attack. You step out of the way. And then you counterpunch. And as I've seen in my life and as you've experienced, who always has the upper hand? It's the person defending. The person attacking might be twice as big, stronger, meaner, you name it. But if they miss their first shot, they're going to have a big fight. It's like watching a Wolverine fight a grizzly bear. That's why they always want to sneak attack and not even let you know they're attacking. So you basically get run over and never know what hit you. Well, we're here telling everybody what's been hitting us. This country, this world has been hit by a globalist bus. And now they want to finish the job. And we're saying, you know what? Blinders are off. The alarm's being raised. You want to fight? It's going to be head to head. You want to bang heads? Get ready. San Jose, California. Michael Zimmerman and Joe Biggs were there. Their footage is up on Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com right now. If you're a radio listener and want to go see it for yourself, you're watching us via Infowars.com/show. You can obviously see us here in living color, and it adds that whole other dimension. It's just one thing to say, hey, people beating up women, men bloodying women's noses, beating them over the head with Mexican flags. It's one thing to hear that. It's another thing to see that. And can you imagine if a group of Anglos were beating up a Hispanic woman and beating her over the head with Mexican flags and hitting her in the head with an egg? Bloodying her nose. You would see people really angry. And you know, I would expect to be angry because it's not just men beating up a woman. It's obviously racial, and black women burning American flags. I mean, this is minorities who are the majority in most areas taught that America is inherently evil and bad because they have no other history in the public school system of any other country. They just have no gauge and just all feel very, very satisfied, very, very self-serving, very, very righteous in what they're doing. Absolutely. Oh, and I love the punching people in the back of the head. Can anybody punch in this country anymore? I mean, I got to tell you, these punches I see people throw must have grown up in a house without daddy there. I mean, that's mommy teach you how to punch. I mean, I'm sorry. That's like putting your fist out and jumping like you're Superman. You want to full force ram somebody up underneath the jaw or the nose. That way you break the jaw and the teeth. And then people understand what it's like to get punched. Or the nose, full power up under. Then the nose goes bye-bye off the face. That's how a man punches. Not all these little superwoman punches where you jump with your fist out. Or hit people like this. And then, but who's even more pathetic is the conditioned American people who stand there, most of them camera people, bystanders, not even Trump supporters, and the police, and watch women and people be punched in the back of the head and assaulted by people wearing all sorts of racist regalia and waving foreign flags. I mean, it is a joke. A giant joke. Can you imagine if it was people in Klan outfits beating up a black woman? It would be the top story worldwide. And I would have the exact same indignation if I saw white men beating up a Hispanic woman or a black woman or an Asian woman. I remember a few years ago when that poor black lady ran up to a checkpoint. They were doing a drill and saw military people and ran away from the checkpoint. Turned out she had mental illness and had kind of run away from home for a few days. She had a child in the back of the car. It was a domestic deal. She was driving around freaking out, crying, you know, fighting with her husband. She was on some type of Prozac family drug, it came out. So it's a woman having a meltdown. Everybody has problems in their life. She freaks out, drives past a checkpoint. Why do we have checkpoints in this country when the border's open? And they shoot her and kill her. And I say, this is horrible. This is terrible. That was back during the Trayvon Martin thing. And people were tweeting and commenting and saying, you only are mad because she's a white woman. And then it turned out she was a black woman. And I said, I never even said she was a white woman or a black woman. From far away in a car, looked like she had dark skin. I didn't even think what color is a woman. See, the people indoctrinated in leftist ideology, whether they be black, Hispanic, white, whatever, they are the most color-obsessed, religion-obsessed people. They're just experts in it. It's all they know. It's all they've been taught in school. It's all they've been taught in the culture. They are basket cases. Basket cases. I mean, I see somebody run over in the road. I don't think, oh, my God, that's a white guy. I really feel bad because they're like me. When I read about little kids dying in car wrecks and it shows their pictures on the news, I have the exact same physical response no matter what color the little kids are. And that's nothing special. That should be normal. But it's crazy how a U-turn at a White House checkpoint led to death. We want to know why this happened. And by the way, it was mainly black cops along with some white cops that shot her to death. And they were all making it racial that I was saying it was wrong she'd be killed, just figuring that she must be white. It's like this gorilla that got shot. There's news articles out saying it only got shot because it was black. This is like Crips and Bloods killing each other over blue or red or all the other stupidness we've seen in history where one group will kill each other just because they're from another town. That's dumbed down tribalism. I remember being like 14 and some of the young people saying, let's go over to that nearby town and see if they're at the park, you know, from that other school and beat them up. I'd be like, I don't want to do that. Well, they're from that other school, and I don't like their football team. That's what it comes down to. So you'll have like a sports team win, people riot. Sports team loses, people riot. And they'll just go out and beat people up. Mobs of idiot white kids in England. Mobs of idiot all races here in the U.S. This is the hooligan idiocy now injected into politics, and with our media fanning the flames of it for social control, it is unprecedented. But the bigger issue is, if the mainstream media, the dinosaur media, the Brian Williams, Katie Couric media, if the Piers Morgan whore media, if they wonder why they have almost no viewers or readers now, a shadow of the former self, look in the mirror. You have a 6% trust rate in a national AP poll 2 months ago because you're known liars. And the public may not get exactly what's going on, but they know you're lying. And so that's why giant lines of people of every race, color, and creed are now showing up at Trump rallies. Suddenly, all over the country, it's like a third or half the people are Hispanic going in. 20% are black. It's like double, you know, the population numbers triple in some cases, 30, 40%. And the system is panicking. Obama is stuttering. And suddenly they're like, what are we going to do? And Trump's saying, let's arrest Hillary. Their bluff is getting called. Their bluff is getting called. People are going, it is true Mexico has the toughest border in this hemisphere. It is true they've got a wall and a fence. And by the way, I've got all these clips of Hispanic groups saying, build that wall. A 2,200-mile wall will not work. You can have them in certain areas to stop cars just driving across and fences. But what you need is ditches. They need to dig ditches with surveillance on the border. And then they need to prosecute employers that knowingly, en masse, hire people to drive down wages in the economy. It's a form of racketeering. They have ways to deal with it. With Trump, it is a dumbed-down gimmick to say, build that wall. But Mexico has one, and other countries have them, and we've paid to put them in Afghanistan and other places. So to say that we can't have a wall and it's evil to have one is ridiculous. Now, I want to get into some more of these clips, but the first one I want to play is a video up on Infowars.com, why social justice warriors are so demented. And I'm going to retweet this out at Real Alex Jones right now while I'm airing this, and I'm going to come back and go back into some of these clips. It's so powerful. I'm going to play it again, where Trump says Hillary Clinton has to go to jail. Then I'm going to play what he said yesterday, where he talked about, you know, these people are all crooked. He's expanding, not just calling her crooked Hillary. He's being serious, saying these are criminals. These are organized crime. And then we're also going to get into more of the mainstream media, the lying media, the crooked media, trying to cover up the racial attacks and just anti-free speech attacks, the brown shirt style, true tyranny attacks going on. Out of one side of their mouth, they're saying it isn't an attack, or saying, oh, there was a clash, both sides did it. But out of the other side of their mouth, they then sit there and say, oh, it's good to go out and attack these people. These are bad people. It's like MSNBC over and over again has said, well, of course we're persecuting the Tea Party and taking away their tax exemptions and going after Christian groups and veterans groups. Of course we're going after you. You're racist. You're bad. You need to be shut down. See, instead of denying they're engaged in Nixonian behavior times 10,000, literally with the IRS, I mean, it's massive scale. Thousands of times bigger than what Nixon did on record. Tens of thousands. They persecuted tens of thousands. Nixon had a list and was thinking about messing with some people, 100 and something. And that was wrong. But look how bad we've gotten now, saying Nixon was the benchmark of evil. We got Roger Stone, who was, you know, worked closely with him and going to be in studio with us for an hour and a half today. He's written the definitive book on Nixon. But we're going to talk in campaign and more with him coming up at the bottom of the next hour. And Joe Biggs will be popping in, who was in the middle of the melee last night. But this is simply incredible. Right now, let's go to Paul Joseph Watson's piece on social justice warriors. And when we come back from the piece, I'm going to add the rest of the story. Because yes, it's about arrested development. Yes, it's about daycare. Yes, it's about mommy not giving attention. Yes, it's about baby-level fighting and then going and tattling to the state, tattling to the monitor, tattling to the welfare attendant, tattling to the daycare attendant. So it's a babyish aggression. Weak, shallow, dumb, gibbering, malnourished, small-brained, dysfunctional people. Because here's the deal. You can look up hundreds of studies on this. Mother's milk. I know it's a conspiracy that women have breasts to feed their young, but mammals have warm blood, they feed their babies from mammary glands, and they have hair. And there's some other features, but most mothers don't breastfeed now because of the industrial society. Most babies are put in cribs. IQs are 10, 20, 30 points higher the more you have a child the first 2 years up against you, up against your skin. They need to be in bed with you every night, up against you. They need to be getting mother's milk to at least 18 months, and the brain, on average, will be 40% larger. That's why Homo sapiens sapiens has a big head for a bigger cc-sized brain. But when you don't get the milk designed to grow the brain's much smaller. They're the autopsy reports are there. People die 25 years old to car wreck. They're not even drug users. They cut open the brain, do an autopsy just to check. The brain is half the size it should be. These are zombies that the formula of the last 60 years is 2/3 high fructose corn syrup on average. These are brain damaged babies who can't talk, and they just run around stomping like babies saying, I deserve a new toy. You're bad. You're racist. You're evil. And that's why whether it's Carl the Cuck or, you know, any of these social justice warriors, they look like they are undead. And it's because they are. When you've got a brain 40% smaller than it should be, okay, you got a problem. They give baboons the average formula, and they can hardly climb a tree. Just put an article up about that a moment ago. So, women got those for a reason. call it a conspiracy theory. They'll probably have Salon come out and say it's not true. Next, an article about how great pedophiles are. But soon it will be a conspiracy theory to say mothers ever gave milk. They're also now even saying we should just outlaw vaginal birth. Or they're saying it's evil. And they want to put statins in the water. So they're coming for us. Now, I got milk till I was 18 months. I walked up in Target, jerking on my mom's pants, and I bossed her around, and I said, Mama, titty. And she said, I think it's time to wean you, because I was, like, pinching on her leg. That's a famous story she tells. But I'm not perfect, but you know what? This big old cranium, that brain got filled out. It's there. And thank God my mother was able to stay home for those first 18 months. She went to work after that, the Dallas Morning News. All right, I'm going to skip this break because it's so important. Let's just go ahead and go to Paul Joseph Watson's report on why these people are so brain damaged and so evil and so wicked, because they are the equivalent of lobotomized goblins. Here it is.
Have you ever wondered why feminists and social justice warriors behave like escaped mental patients?
Oh, we should talk.
Why are they so loud and obnoxious?
You're a white male!
Despite looking like the cast from a pilot show called The Unbelievables, why are they always trying to be the center of attention? Turns out it might be because mommy didn't give them enough huggles. As Laura Perrins explains, we're talking about the daycare generation. These kids grew up in the 90s when feminists assured us that nursery care was completely healthy. Turns out that was bull. A 2001 National Institute of Child Health and Development study revealed a link between long hours of non-maternal care for young children and aggressive behavior. In other words, you had two dozen insecure screaming brats all competing for the attention of one stressed out daycare worker. The love and protection of mother's safe space was nowhere to be seen, and the only way to be heard was to throw a massive tantrum. So SJWs are craving the comfort and security of home that they never had growing up.
It is not about creating an intellectual space. It is not. Do you understand that? It's about creating a home here.
They're addicted to being treated like special snowflakes because mommy didn't shower them with enough love. They're obsessed with making crazy demands to grab the attention that they were denied in daycare.
You should step down.
So there you have it. Psychologically speaking, social justice warriors are mentally stunted toddlers who throw fits when they don't get their own way because they never learned to interact like normal humans. They're so full of righteous indignation because they're inflicting revenge on the world for their emotionally deprived childhoods.
Stop talking to us like children!
And even though they're adolescent crybabies, scared of Halloween costumes and other people's opinions, let's take the high road. Let's be compassionate. Let's be kind. Hug a social justice warrior today. Actually, that. Let's just keep triggering the little s***. It's hilarious.
All right, I don't like Paul Watson's use of profanity, and I apologize for that. He's trying to cut back on it, but quite frankly, it's a tactic he's using, and his videos are getting millions of views a day in many cases. And almost every high school student I run into, literally, that's politically involved is now watching his videos and tuning into InfoWars. And so fight fire with fire. I don't really agree with that overall, but it's working. And I'm the guy that made Paul get on the air 5 years ago, so I guess I kind of asked for it. People at the school level, middle school, high school, into college, are really starting to figure out what's going on. And they shouldn't be guilty. They shouldn't be brainwashed. They shouldn't be told America's bad. They shouldn't have all this garbage pushed on them. But I'm not kidding. I need to do more videos about vaccines causing brain damage, lower IQ, fluoride causing lower IQ. That's Harvard study. Look it up for yourself. I'm talking 10-point reduction in just 6 years of use at 1.3 parts per million. Look it up. You add screen time, the television, rewiring the brain, lowering synapse connections, lowering attention span to that of a goldfish. The average person has an attention span lower than that of a goldfish. It's why they can't carry out tasks either. No one remembers what was said to them 60 seconds before. And the establishment people say, well, that's good, Alex. We can just rule over all these idiots. I don't want to rule over a planet of morons, planet goldfish brain. It also burns out your pancreas. You wonder why these kids weigh twice what they should by the time they're 14 years old. There's no exercise. The average North American gets less time, Europeans as well, outside than a maximum security prisoner. That's a federal study out a month ago. Look it up. Just type that in. Everything I'm telling you, type it in. The average child in the West spends less time outside than a maximum security prisoner. Close quote. Children now spend less time outside than the average prisoner. Look it up for yourself. So, we laugh at these people, we make fun of them, and Paul's doing that lovingly because that's all they listen to, because they're at childlike level. They get the average person, and I'm going to play a Trump clip in a moment, into college. They're already primed to be social justice warriors. They're already guilty, you know, in their heart, even though they've done nothing. And they take them into these communal areas and dress them down and yell at them. And if they're a minority, they say you're persecuted. Folks are out to get you. There's big racism on this campus. There's epidemics of rape. Look out. Oh, my gosh. They trigger all this hysteria and fight and flight. They don't want your parents to do that and teach you real threats. Then they don't want you to have that in high school. They want you to be insulated. Then in college, they scare you and freak you out, give you false stimuli, try to activate instincts that are there, and then misdirect them to your enemy is white people. Your enemy is money. Your enemy is success. Your enemy is anyone who has more money than you. Your enemy is anyone better looking than you. You are going to be a failure unless you're part of this group, part of this guild. Here, the Ford Foundation loves you. La Raza Mecha loves you. Black Lives Matter, funded by Soros, loves you. And now you're a prisoner for life. You will do whatever they say. You will read their books, watch their TV shows, follow their directives. You are now a total mind slave. And you drank fluoride your whole life. You had formula designed to massively reduce the CC size of your brain from 20 to 45% on average. It's in that spectrum, depending on the formula. You are a victim of a technotronic psycho global program that's declassified. You were hit and hit hard. And they just hope that you don't care and join them like a zombie. But many of you would have been geniuses. Now you still have average intelligence, and that's who I'm targeting, myself included. My dad was like one of the top people in the state at mathematics, engineering. He was in UT when he was a junior in high school. Salutatorian high school, would have been valedictorian, but he was too busy already, you know, working in cancer research facilities in Houston when he was 16. Everybody else before me on the other side of the family was smarter than I am cognitively, literary, language, you name it. But I've still got all my primitive instincts that are good. But I'm brain damaged. I'm probably 20, 30 points lower than I should be. I should be about 150 IQ. Those of us that still can operate, we have to realize we've been hit with chemical and biological and cultural attack. We got to shake it off, realize it's basically an alien attack by a psycho breakaway group of controllers. And then if we know we're under attack, humans can then work around it and actually boost your cognitive ability once you know you're under attack instinctively. I'm going to stop right there and play this clip because it's so powerful. Trump. Hillary Clinton has to go to jail. This is next level. This is firing back. This will bring them down. Here it is.
By the way, Hillary Clinton is missing 30,000 emails. They've been deleted. 30,000. 30,000 emails. And remember I said I was a counterpuncher? I am. After what she said about me today in her phony speech, that was a phony speech. That was a Donald Trump hit job. I will say this, Hillary Clinton has to go to jail, okay? She has to go to jail. Has to go. That was a phony hit job. She's guilty as hell. Remember, Hillary Clinton used to hate Obama. She used to hate him. Bill Clinton hated him. Bill Clinton hated him. He called Bill Clinton a racist. Do you remember that? Bill Clinton hated him. And Hillary Clinton hated Obama. Now it's, yes, sir, Mr. President, sir. Yes, sir. What would you like? What would you like me to say here, sir? The only reason she's behaving like this, and the only reason she's been dragged so far left Believe me, is she doesn't want to go to jail over the emails, okay? Believe me. That's the only reason. One simple reason.
Ladies and gentlemen, that is powerful info. I'm going to play more of the clips here in a moment. But first off, we're running a special until this sells out. It looks like that'll be Monday at current sales rates because I just, you know, a year ago said, hey, when, you know, the summer starts and the allergy season gets really bad in some areas, I want a 20% lung cleanse special. A lot of this is already pre-programmed into the shopping cart. So that special started, but we have a limited supply of it. And so it will be sold out by Monday at current sales rates. Introduce yourself to this very low price, high quality product. It's $23.96 at $20 off. Other competitors are just two or three essential oils and maybe some menthol to halfway numb your throat. This is close to 20. Totally organic, cold pressed, over the top, awesome ingredients. And there's no other system out there. I've tried a lot of them when I've been speaking too much and my voice is too raspy and my voice is going out. They don't help me. This does help. And it does have menthol as well. That's the last ingredient. But it's got organic peppermint essentials, organic chaparral leaf, organic lobelia, organic, it goes on and I can't pronounce half of these, organic orange peel. It's got proprietary blend. It's got just a whole bunch of eucalyptus oil, organic lugwort, organic oregano, organic plantain, organic. I mean, it just goes on and on. It's so good. And it's 20% off right now at InfoWarsLife.com. And the small profit we make helps fund this operation. We're also going to be ending it next week, the special on the new Alexa Pure Breeze air filter systems. Competitors are $400 to $500, some of them $1,000 for something that has the exact same specs. This is 25% off out of the gates, $184 for a filter that should be $400. That'd be low priced. Alexa Pure Breeze, InfoWarsStore.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. I'm Alex Jones. Stay with us. Second hour, Roger Stone and more coming up in studio. Peter Schweitzer, heads up Breitbart, has written the best-selling book, Clinton Cash. It's now been turned into a film that's about to come out. And he'll be joining us for about 20, 30 minutes coming up at the start of the next segment. Then Roger Stone is going to be in studio with us, and he's got a lot to talk about, obviously, and we're going to be doing some interviews over the weekend as well that everyone is going to want to stay tuned for. Everything Stone has told us has been basically spot on. I mean, it's actually crazy when I think back. What has he told me that hadn't been accurate? And it's all been just dead on, scary accurate. Very, very exciting that Trump has taken the gloves off and is calling Hillary Clinton a criminal now and saying she should go to jail. Not just crooked Hillary and laughing about it. He's saying she's a crook, she's a criminal, she should go to jail, and here's the crime she's committed. That's how you devastate criminals, is you break their facade of infallibility, their facade of invincibility, and Hillary's facade has fallen. Trump has destroyed Hillary Clinton. It's now happening. She may be able to try to lash out and bring him down somehow, but at this point, I'm telling you, that just like the allegory of Force 10 from Navarone, which is a composite of true stories, part two of The Guns of Navarone. It's a good movie with Harrison Ford in it. I was seeing it when I was like 3 years old. But the point is that they bombed the dam to flood the river to stop the German advance in a battle in the Balkans. And they bombed the dam and it doesn't fall right away. And they says, just give it some time. And about 10 minutes later, the cracks form, the pressure forms, the dam collapses. And I'll use another analogy. Spock in Wrath of Khan gets radiated, and he says, let's get him out of there to save his life. And they go, he's dead already. It's a, what's the word for it? Pyrrhic victory. Hillary can only have a Pyrrhic victory now. In fact, the more Machiavellian side of me that I never use, but I do look into, so I can see how the globalists are thinking and operating. And beyond that, of course, that's only a beginning level. They make it so complex, the fraud, that soon they don't even know where they are in this ethereal fog of baloney that they spew out. But there really is no way for Hillary to put herself back together again like the proverbial Humpty Dumpty. Even if she gets into office, she will wreck the whole system. She won't be able to push through martial law. The woman thing, you know, that gimmick will wear off even faster than Barack Obama gimmick will wear off. And If the establishment was smart right now in a sick way, I say justice be done, may the heavens fall. But at the same time, so I'm supporting Trump, even though there's some risk there and some problems, and it's not a perfect path out of this. It's just a manifestation of populism. If they let Trump get in, imploded the economy, which they're planning to do, blame it on nationalism and decisions he made, then they could try to dent populism and somehow recast it as bad and discredit it. But they're so arrogant, they want to maintain control and are really going to try to stop him. So this is not some super sophisticated deal to put Trump in and he doesn't know he's being set up. That's being discussed now because they think they might not be able to stop him, and that'll be their plan B. But that's where the pieces are on the chessboard, if you ask old Alejandro Jones. So we're going to be talking with Roger Stone about that as well and a lot more. We'll talk about keys to victory. We'll talk about the Never Trump movement that has died like a Hillary Clinton book, and nobody wants to buy those. We're also talking about the women's issues, Broderick, Willie, and others. We'll talk about financial institutions, super PACs, vice president, Cleveland Convention. They're establishing guidelines to make it difficult to get our permits. I knew that was coming, trying to block us from getting in there. San Jose, violent Trump rally protesters. You know, I love how they're going to try to keep the press, the real press that has bigger audiences than CNN out, or even people that are real delegates. All the action's outside anyways. You keeping us outside is what certifies us as good. I mean, they just don't get it. And we're back, ladies and gentlemen. Roger Stone is here in Austin, Texas, the consummate Trump insider. He's going to be in studio with us for an hour and a half. Then Anthony Gucciardi takes over the fourth hour. We'll have Joe Biggs and Michael Zimmerman, our reporters, on the ground in Irvine, where the rioting looks like it's already starting on their feeds. Those feeds are up on Infowars.com. That's all because the tech editor of Breitbart decided that he'd go speak at a couple of universities, and this is day four of the hysteria, as people with Mexican flags and eggs beat up women. And, of course, the men, the reporters, the police, all just stand around and allow it to happen. And we've got the mayor and others saying, this is what you deserve. That was in San Jose yesterday. This is what you deserve because Trump is evil. I mean, even if I didn't support Trump, which I do overall, I have some issues with him. How about the First Amendment? I mean, this is really a scary time to see where these people are going. And in Europe, and you name it, they're trying to arrest people. They're trying to put in EU-wide laws for government ID of the internet to track and tax you. That's up on DrudgeReport.com right now, our Infowars.com story. But speaking of Breitbart, Peter Schweitzer is our guest at the bottom of the hour. Breitbart.com, g-a.i.org. I'm not going to go over his whole long bio. He's a pretty well-known journalist and fellow out there and heads up Breitbart. I want to talk about the state of the internet, the state of this country, the state of the world, where Hillary wants to restrict our speech, but she can get $100 million from Gulf states that chain women up and put, you know, bags over their heads. This is really a time when it looks like they're making their move to try to take over this country. And he's written the best-selling book, Clinton Cash, that he'll break down, that's about to premiere at Cannes based on the New York Times best-selling book, the most feared book of the presidential cycle, Clinton Cash. So what are they so scared of? Because it's not just having modern leftist brown shirts beat women up in California on TV, and local TV defends it. I mean, that's in the news, Infowars.com. We have links to mainstream news. It's not just that. Now it's try to shut off the money to libertarian and conservative and constitutionalist groups. Don't give them tax exemptions or take them away, but then let Hillary get money from dictators. I mean, they're making their move, in my view, but I want to ask Peter Schweitzer his view on this and to ask him the question, is liberty winning or is tyranny winning in this football game? I mean, how would he boil this down when we look at the different forces that are at play here? Peter, thanks for coming on with us.
Hey, great. Thanks for having me, Alex. I always enjoy being on with you.
You bet. I think this is your second or third visit with us. Let's talk about Clinton Cash and now turning into a film and why this is so important.
Well, I think it's important for a couple of reasons. First of all, we follow the money. This is something that you would expect mainstream journalists to do. They talk about money in politics all the time. But the fact of the matter is no one has gone and dissected who gave the Clintons money, why they gave them money, and when they gave them money. And by the way, Alex, What's, I think, so troubling and compelling about the Clinton case is we're not just talking about Wall Street or big oil or the traditional sources of money in American politics. What we're talking about is foreign governments, foreign dictators, and foreign financiers. This is a way where foreign entities have figured out a way around U.S. laws that prevent them from giving money to political candidates. They can now put it in the Clintons' pockets through speaking fees or give it to the Clinton Foundation and curry favor and access that way.
And then, of course, I know Breitbart, other than Drudge, is probably the main victim of Facebook censorship. We have enjoyed it as well, where we send out a meme that's PG-rated, and then they suspend us for 3 days. The founder of Pirate Bay came out on Monday and said, look, Facebook is a multi-billion person nation, and its dictator is Zuckerberg, who is anti-free speech. And that's a leftist saying that about Zuckerberg. I mean, this is something everybody should be worried about.
Yeah, I mean, control of the media and who really determines what gets shown as trending on Facebook, what's shown on the evening news is vitally important. And here's the problem, Alex. It's one thing if there were some balance, but just look at this issue of the money flowing to the Clintons. We talk, for example, in Clinton Cash, we have two chapters on the fact that the Clintons got $145 million from investors in this small uranium company that needed Obama administration approval to sell uranium in the United States to the Russian government. Okay, that's an important story. And in fact, even the New York Times ran a 4,000-word front page piece confirming all of it. They ran that piece last year when Clinton Cash was published. Hillary Clinton has not been asked a single question about that by any mainstream media reporter. You would think if there was a 4,000-word front page investigative piece in the New York Times on Bernie Sanders, on Donald Trump, on Ted Cruz, whoever you want, they would be asked that question. But somehow with the Clintons, they never get asked these very basic, simple questions about follow the money.
And it's basic sovereignty issue. I mean, what is the elite thinking? You've written for some of those powerful publications out there that the elite, you know, go by: Foreign Affairs, New York Times, Wall Street Journal, Washington Post, Los Angeles Times, National Review. And what I think is important about your leadership at Breitbart that I really have enjoyed seeing develop is that you guys are just really going for populism and the truth. America is being conquered right now. Yeah, it sounds sensational, but they're announcing world government. I mean, the truth is this is happening, and we have a choice to make. Are we going to be ruled by multinationals and the Saudis and the communist Chinese and all these combines, or are we going to be ruled by the vote and this republic? And I just think that, you know, thank God your book has been used as a roadmap the last year, now about to be a film, now being released, to force this serious debate about, is there any line in the sand for the establishment? Because, you know, even when guys like you, I don't want to say you're establishment, but you're, you know, a conservative, you know, well-known, you know, guy that, you know, the establishment listens to. I mean, what are they saying at this point? I mean, because I know the military, I talked to high-level brass who are currently in, they are freaking out about what's going on. Has America reached a tipping point in awakening is what I'm trying to get at.
Well, yeah, I think there's a lot of interesting things going on in this election. You alluded to it earlier. I mean, I have not been, you know, a completely rabid, you know, Trump supporter. There's some things that he said that I don't necessarily agree with. But it is impossible to ignore the fact that the issues that he is raising on issues like sovereignty, on issues relating to the American middle class, that they are no longer being represented in Washington, D.C. anymore. And you could say the same thing with Bernie Sanders. I don't agree with Bernie Sanders on probably anything, but you've got to give him a lot of credit. He is touching on these very same themes. And this is a trend that we've seen, Alex, over the last 20 to 30 years. It's been written about by everyone from Harvard faculty members to conservatives and libertarians. We have a trend in this country that many of the elites in the United States today in both political parties frankly have more in common and have a closer identity with elites in other countries than they do with people in their own country. They feel that they have more in common with elites in Brussels or in Beijing than they do with elites that live in Des Moines or Bakersfield. And that is a problem.
I want to talk about the film with you and how important it is premiering in Cannes. I mean, this is a big deal because if folks think, you know, your book's already almost brought down the Clintons and others and exposed this destruction of our sovereignty, this takeover, imagine it being a blockbuster like 2016. Hopefully they won't, you know, arrest you or the filmmaker, like they've done Dinesh D'Souza. And then I want to talk to you about the EU proposed government ID to use the internet in the new European Commission draft report, because this is a dictatorship. They just issue these reports and then they bounce them around and they become, quote, law. So they're dropping the hammer. But first, let's talk about the film.
Yeah, the film is really basically an attempt to make the material in the book more accessible to people. I mean, we get the fact that people are busy, people are working hard, and when they get home from work, they don't necessarily want to dive into a, you know, several hundred page book that's got multiple footnotes. So what the film does is take some of the material in the film, there's some new stuff as well, and it encapsulates it and presents it in a very visual and powerful way. And what's interesting about this, Alex, is the earliest reviews of this film were not by conservatives, people that dislike Hillary Clinton. It was by MSNBC. It was by Salon. It was by The Guardian in the UK, which is a left-wing paper. They all gave the film favorable reviews because they feel the information is compelling and powerful, and you can not deny the fact that the Clintons are cooperating and working with elites that are backing warlords in Africa or engaged in some very nefarious behavior.
Well, that's the thing about Hillary.
Other places around the world.
From a leftist perspective, she's what you'd call a super right-wing warmonger, profiteer, gangster, like Trump says. I mean, there's nothing liberal about this woman except her rhetoric.
Yeah, the word that I often hear from Bernie Sanders supporters that I would agree with is that she is a corporatist. Then, in other words, she melds her interest in American national interest with the interests of favored corporations, and that would be corporations that put money in their pockets. So she's going to carry out a policy in Africa, for example, that's not necessarily based on our national security interests or in the interests of human rights, but what's best for mining corporations that have put a lot of money in the Clinton pockets. And that's something that I think a lot of conservatives and independents would have problems with. And it's certainly something that Bernie Sanders supporters
sure
would have a problem with.
Now, there's Breitbart.com. People can go see the trailer there. We're going to play the trailer when we come back at the start of the next segment, right out of the break, viewers and listeners. So stay tuned for that. But Peter Schweitzer, who heads up Breitbart.com, one of the biggest independent news organizations in the world. Let me ask you this when we got a break in 60 seconds. I mean, I wouldn't call you an establishment guy, but I mean, I'm going to go over your bio here, but you're a prestigious guy. I've worked with some of the, you know, top TV production, you name it, some of the top publications. People listen to you. Would you say that other people in the more intellectual, you know, a level of discourse are now starting to wake up to what's happening? Because, you know, you supporting Trump and things like that's pretty hardcore in the traditional paradigm.
Well, I would say that, yes, there's a lot of disruption among establishment circles that are surprised at what's happening. Certainly, you know, the predictions that a lot of people have made have been proven to be wrong. But I would say even at Breitbart, look, we have a very vigorous debate. You know, I'm a senior editor there, the executive chairman, Steve Bannon, Alex Marlowe, the editor-in-chief. We have vigorous debates on these issues. What I find so interesting is a lot of the focus is on the personality of Donald Trump.
Issues. Stay there, Peter Schweitzer. We're going to be right back to talk about this straight ahead in the trailer. Out of the break. Stay with us. Alex Jones back live. ClintonCashMovie.com is the website. Here is the trailer for the film that opens in Cannes this weekend.
Greetings from Washington. I want to thank all of you for your work to root out corruption that weakens economic development, feeds black markets and organized crime, and undermines the promise of democracy.
I believe in the oldest adage in American politics, which is follow the money.
A new report today claims that the Clinton Foundation gives about 10% of its money that it raises to actual charities.
Enormous amounts of money have flowed to the Clintons from foreign governments, foreign financiers, and businesses.
The Clinton Foundation dropping its self-imposed ban on collecting funds from foreign governments and entities.
You have a foreign corporation or a foreign government that wants something from the State Department while Hillary Clinton is Secretary of State. They will make a large payment to the Clinton Foundation. That will be followed by favorable action on their behalf. They've created a model for massive self-enrichment that allows you to go into so-called public service, but get extremely rich at the same time.
Oh, yeah. I got to pay our bills.
Before we had to worry about money from Wall Street and big labor, now we have to worry about it coming from around the world and infecting our politics. With the Clintons, nothing is sacred. Everything is for sale. But we are the ones who are paying the price. Maybe, just maybe, the American people are tired of being sold out.
I can't wait to see it. A really smart film, because I've read the book, I guess, 6 months ago, about 4 or 5 months, 6 months after it came out. Congratulations on what you put together here. You were finishing up on the whole Trump situation and how really what he's saying is mainline Americana, but people get caught up in the personality, Peter.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you look at some of the positions he's taken, whether it's on, free trade or the erosion of the middle class, these are hardly, radical right-wing views. These are centrist views that are shared by some mainstream Democrats. And I think that part of the challenge is because of Trump's personality, sometimes those issues get lost in the shuffle. So I think it's going to be very interesting. It's going to be very difficult for Hillary Clinton, I think, to paint Trump as this sort of right-wing conservative, because certainly that is not how you would classify Trump, I think, on the philosophical spectrum.
And to be specific, I know Kansas was going on the last week or so. I guess it's already premiered. Where will we be able to see Clinton Cash next?
So it's in the middle of negotiations for distribution deal. There's going to be a theatrical release sometime in July, and then we will be on a television network. I can't say which one, but expect to see it on national television sometime this summer.
Well, it needs to go viral, and folks, this is a war. I don't have a stake in this film except my children's future. That's why all these big films, I have them on to promote them, because if it gets in 20 theaters and sells out for a week, then it gets in 100, then it's 2,000. And then we change the world. And look, it's not just the Clintons. It's across the board. These leaders are taking foreign money. And the left says, get rid of Americans' right to give. Well, first, let's get rid of foreign groups coming in and dictatorships. And you're absolutely right. The left has no wiggle room here. I mean, if they're for shutting down giving domestically, they got to shut down foreign money. I mean, that's treason.
Yeah, that's right. And I mean, that's one of the few consensus points we have left in American politics, right? The Supreme Court in 2012 heard a case where two Canadians challenged the constitutionality of the law that says foreigners cannot give to political campaigns. The Supreme Court came back 9-0 and said, no, this law is completely constitutional and makes great sense. When was the last time the Supreme Court agreed 9-0 on anything? So this is a consensus point in American politics, but the Clintons have found a way around it. So if you're a foreign dictator, you cannot give to Hillary's presidential campaign, but you can pay Bill an inflated speaking fee and put that money in his pocket.
I mean, it's even worse than giving to the campaign.
Check to the Clinton Foundation.
Well, I mean, in closing, Trump has come out and said that she's going to jail now. And obviously she does all these crimes. They're legion. But I mean, it's naked. If somebody at the FBI takes $5,000 from a foreigner and doesn't even do anything for the money, they get indicted in life in prison, and they should. That's espionage. I mean, they're openly involved in espionage, you know, at every level. I mean, how is she not arrested?
Well, you look, Alex, at the recent cases of political prosecution, Governor McDonnell in Virginia, Senator Menendez in New Jersey, they were charged with far less evidence than exists.
The Attorney General of Texas.
Attorney General of Texas. There's a former governor of Alabama who's in jail right now. They were charged on this precise thing of taking money and doing favors in return. And the evidence that I've looked at is far less compelling in any of those cases.
The Attorney General here is going after Obama. He's at a party, talks about a company he was at a year before, says he thinks it's a good investment. They've indicted him. It's just crazy. Dinesh D'Souza's in jail for 9 months. Hillary's not in trouble. Peter Schweitzer, Breitbart.com. Clinton Cash, the movie, folks. Very exciting. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Alex.
Wow, we're on the march. The Empire is on the run. And the next big salvo's coming up. Roger Stone in studio straight ahead. And we have a special guest in studio. I mean, I knew who this guy was years ago. Ran into him at some JFK events. But I tell you, in the last year, getting to know Roger Stone, it's been amazing. He's a consummate Trump insider. He's a best-selling author. He's worked in 9 administrations or on 9 campaigns. I guess in like 4 administrations, correct me if I'm wrong, and of course famously good buddies with Richard Nixon. And I tell you, you look at Richard Nixon, where are the good old days? That guy's so-called corruption was like child's play, and I'm not defending it, obviously. You've written a book that's somewhat critical of him, but also positive. He was a real guy. What is the difference, Roger Stone, between a Richard Nixon and, say, a Hillary or Bill Clinton or an Obama? Because you've got a bunch of breaking news, a bunch of inside stuff. We've got a ton of anti-Trump rioters beating up women, hitting them over the head with Mexican flags, and the mayor defending it is wonderful. I mean, these people seem like the real brown shirt fascists to me. I want to cover that today with you and all the points you want to get to. But first off, let's quantify your 40-something years in politics and your business partner, you know, being one of the top folks right now, heading up the Trump campaign a year ago or so. You were the head of the Trump campaign. Now you're out there on your own to defend the republic. But so much, where are we as a culture, as a society, and how would you parallel it between a Richard Milhouse Nixon and a Hillary Rodham Clinton? What type of individuals are these? I mean, was Nixon a sociopath or a psychopath? We know Hillary is.
Well, put it this way. Hillary and Bill Clinton make Richard Nixon look like St. Thomas Aquinas. I mean, the unconstitutional abuses of power by both the Clintons and the Obamas pale in comparison to anything Richard Nixon did. Let's take a simple example. One of the counts of impeachment against Richard Nixon was that he misused the IRS. Really? Kathleen Willey, Juanita Broderick, Paula Jones, they all got IRS audits. All the women sexually assaulted by Bill Clinton got IRS audits. But there was never an article of impeachment on the Clintons. The extra constitutional ravings and orders of Barack Obama pale in comparison in anything Richard Nixon did. It shows that there's a double standard between conservative Republicans and liberal Democrats. Republicans are held to a higher standard.
And it seems to be getting worse. I know you flew in last night, but you've seen some of the news today. We covered it last hour. You have left-wing editors of newspapers. You have the mayor out there in the town where this just happened, where Breitbart and of course, our own reporters are there having events, and they're coming in and beating up women now on TV, waving Mexican flags in San Jose, and the media is saying this is a good thing. Now, this is unprecedented.
Yeah, I actually think, and Pat Buchanan wrote this last week very eloquently, all these demonstrations, all this violence is only going to redound to the benefit of Donald Trump. The lines are drawn in America between the producers and the takers. And the more they foment violence, and let's be very clear, this violence is agitprop. It's paid for. It's orchestrated. It's a faux demonstration. These are hardline professional agitators financed by George Soros, MoveOn.org, Black Lives Matter, David Brock and the freaks at Media Matters for America, then go out and interpret it, blaming all of the violence on Trump. Hardworking, blue-collar Americans see this violence and they repair to the Trump banner. In my view, the entire thing will backfire.
I agree, and it's on record. In Europe, the tactics, bully and attack, and then shut down conservatives or patriot speech, nationalist speech. It's the same mode here. It's the same leftist blueprint with big corporations that want monopolies funding it, but it is backfiring all over the world. So then I ask, what is George Soros and Hillary Clinton, what are they thinking?
I think it's just it's a miscalculation. Here is what they're trying to do. There is a morbid fear on the left that many of the Bernie Sanders voters are going to wise up to the fact that the internationalist globalist trade deals like NAFTA have destroyed the job market in the United States, and that the neocon policies of both the Clintons and the Bushes have driven us all off to endless and pointless war. They're deathly afraid that one-third, not the hard left, but one-third of the Sanders voters will become available to Trump. And therefore, these riots, these attacks, he's a racist, he's a bigot, he's a maniac, he's mentally unbalanced, that is meant to disqualify Trump among those voters. They are desperate to disqualify them because they're outsiders. These folks are natural Trump voters. We have common economic interests with them, and that is what they fear.
He's in a dead heat or a few points ahead in most polls. You're the expert on that. Correct me if I'm wrong. Where is the state of the battle? What's the path to victory, A? But B, clearly, I don't need to be a political scientist to know that most people out there, you know, feel intimidated because they don't want to be called racist. But secretly, they're planning to vote for Trump because they're nationalists, they're patriots. And I'm talking about black voters, Hispanics, and others, because I'm suddenly seeing double, triple the numbers of Hispanics and African-American folks at the Trump rallies, because we have the live feeds. Our crew is at almost all of these. Infowars.com is covering it. And I'm not seeing that on the news now. They're not doing close-up shots of the lines anymore because it's freaking the media out. And now suddenly, in multiple speeches, when Obama talks about Trump, he turns into a blithering idiot, and I think he's got him, and the people have him completely rattled right now.
Yeah, I think what's happening here is that you have a well-oiled political machine run by the Clintons, and it is extremely well-funded. Just the super PACs supporting Hillary have raised $85 million and have another $48 million on hand. Compare that with the Trump organization and the Trump campaign. This is an entirely indigenous, grassroots, guerrilla campaign. Trump has managed to get nominated without polling, without sophisticated analytics and targeting, without massive hundreds of millions of dollars worth of both positive and negative TV commercials. It's an uprising. It's a citizen insurgency, and it's going to take on the best oiled, best funded political operation probably in American history. An operation that has been very successful at controlling the narrative because of their close associates, association, and their simpatico views with the mainstream media. Trump is able, because he's going to be the nominee, to break through all of that. So would Marco Rubio or Chris Christie or any of these other candidates called Hillary Clinton a crook? No, only Donald Trump has the cojones to do that.
In fact, we've got that queued up. I don't normally play a clip five or six times during a broadcast, but Trump, the clip's up on Infowars.com. Steve Watson wrote an article about it. Spread this out to everybody. Hillary Clinton has to go to jail. She's guilty as hell.
By the way, Hillary Clinton is missing 30,000 emails. They've been deleted. 30,000. 30,000 emails. And remember I said I was a counterpuncher? I am. After what she said about me today in her phony speech, that was a phony speech. That was a Donald Trump hit job. I will say this. Hillary Clinton has to go to jail, okay? She has to go to jail.
I'm going to play more of it. This is unprecedented in modern politics. This is the end of an era, folks. This is...
She's
even
guilty
if Trump
as
doesn't
hell.
Win, this brings him down.
Remember, Hillary Clinton used to hate Obama. She used to hate him. Bill Clinton hated him. Bill Clinton hated him. He called Bill Clinton a racist. Do you remember that? Bill Clinton hated him.
All right.
And Hillary Clinton hated Obama. Now it's, yes, sir, Mr. President, sir. Yes, sir. What would you like? What would you like me to say here, sir? The only reason she's behaving like this, and the only reason she's been dragged so far left, believe me, is she doesn't want to go to jail over the emails, okay? Believe me. That's the
it.
Only reason.
30,000 of them.
One simple reason.
That's good. I mean, this is coffin nails. This is unprecedented. And look, my gut told me Trump was good over a year ago. That's why I've been supporting him. But now I'm so proud I'm supporting him because I can tell he is for real. He has gotten so serious. It's not even a joke now, and the numbers are going up. You've known this guy for 40-plus years. You don't talk about your private, you know, relationship with him, but you've been his wingman, you name it, when he's not married. You know, you're buddies. You know, not just been in business together. They're saying on Bill Maher that he's dumbing it down for the public. Well, no. I mean, I think he's just simplifying it to cut through the garbage. But who is the real Donald Trump? Is this the real Donald Trump?
Yeah, he's blunt. He's plain spoken. He talks the way regular people talk. He doesn't talk the way politicians talk after their advisors say, oh, no, you need to say this or you need to say that, or the poll shows this or the focus group show that. See, that's Hillary. It comes across exactly what it is. Phony, totally phony. You can see the way she calibrates her speech. There's nothing sincere. There's nothing real. It's whatever her advisors have told her to say that day. Dangerous Donald. How many times did they poll that? Did they compare it to duplicitous Donald and see which one is better? I mean,
look, and by the way, what's this thing now where if she's in Kentucky, she talks like that. If she's in Texas, it's so, or if she talks to Hispanics, she talks in this fake Hispanic accent. And then now I've seen these videos. In fact, I meant to grab them last night and tell the crew. I saw her in a speech going like a robot with her arms out, and she goes, and like opens her eyes up real big to look like menacing and goes, I mean, she looks like a freaking lunatic, man. What is going on with her?
I don't think her health is good. I don't think she has the stamina for the campaign.
They put her on speed or something, didn't they?
And these carefully calibrated, uber-planned, over-planned modern campaign doesn't know how to deal with the free-floating spirit of Donald Trump. Trump is unhandled.
Is that why Obama seems like he's really jolted?
They're flummoxed because the only thing predictable about Donald Trump is that he is completely unpredictable. And they don't know where he's going to come. So he's right. 30,000 emails that would show you the nexus between the Clinton Foundation and the Clinton State Department and demonstrate that everything was for sale. You need approval for an arms deal. You need to corner the market on U.S. uranium. You need a foreign policy change to get rid of Gaddafi so you can move in on the oil. Just grease Bill and Hillary. That's all you got to do.
Absolutely. Roger Stone's our guest. Or he's readjusting his earpiece there for TV, which reminds me to tell everybody, we're not just radio. We're also television. Infowars.com/show and more cable and TV stations around the country are picking us up. Buckley's been out to some big events with some big networks, and we're going to be on a lot of other affiliates here in the new future. Some big announcements as well, because liberty is so popular. And Donald Trump knows he's riding that populist wave. This is happening in other places in the world. That's what's so exciting. And the establishment's going to have real trouble putting this back in the bottle, as I've said so many times. So, Roger, what else do we have to look for? Will they try to steal the nomination at the RNC in Cleveland, or is that pretty much dead now?
I don't think there will be an effort there. I think you've got some bitter enders who are still loyal to Ted Cruz, but the Trump folks now and Paul Manafort, who is the consummate convention operative, they have firm control of the Rules Committee, of the Platform Committee, of the Credentials Committee now. So I think mischief at the convention is unlikely. I'm looking forward to a very, very conservative platform. I don't see us having big platform fights. I'll tell you what the problem is in Cleveland right now, and you know this. We, originally starting as a Stop the Steal rally, applied for a permit for a giant outdoor rally. And it has now been almost 2 months since we have applied for our permit. Now, suddenly, the city of Cleveland is coming back and telling us they have guidelines. The guidelines are meant to censor us. The bottom line is they don't want this peaceful rally to happen. What's ironic, of course, is that in our dealings with the Cleveland police, they all say, look, I'm being told I have to tell you this, but we love Trump. I'm sorry, you can't have your rally. I mean, it is ironic.
But meanwhile, the Hillary people can run around and attack women and burn things down.
They don't apply for permits. They don't check in with the police. They just show up and start swinging. So,
well, I'm here to tell Cleveland, though, I'm going there regardless. I got a First Amendment, especially when they try to steal this nomination. They're gonna have all those communists running around. And so, what do we do? I guess we got to file a lawsuit because I mean, look, let me guess the guidelines, Roger. They're going to make us be like 5 miles away in a ditch where nobody can see us, or what?
Yeah, it's unclear. The gentleman who is organizing this, Tim Salati Sr., a real patriot, locked in conversations with the city of Cleveland, trying to get to the bottom line. This rally is happening.
Oh, yeah, folks, come there, be there. You know there's going to be shenanigans. We just need to be there regardless.
Absolutely. And it's
because we try to get the permits. We try to do it all. But when they try to say no, we don't need that for a rally unless it's blocking roads. We're just going to pick some park and be there.
Yeah, look, the point here, of course, is numbers. We need to show the numbers. We need to show the force of Trump in numbers.
And by the way, you know, the police all over the country are ordered to let leftists attack people and stand down. Imagine the image of the cops try to stop us but let the communists run around. That's going to look, the only way we lose is not showing up. Resistance is victory. We've got to engage.
Yeah, I agree with that. I also don't think that the Cleveland police are going to do this. If we are permitted, they will have an obligation to protect the gathering from violence, which is why we...
Well, sure, it's going to be Black Lives Matter and communists out there that want them dead, so they better support the First Amendment.
No, look, I think we may end up having to put pressure on the city of Cleveland to preserve our First Amendment rights and our rights to be heard.
All right, Roger Stone, we're going to break in a moment. You have got a bunch of stuff we're going to be going over. We'll also be opening the phones up. Whole nother hour with Roger Stone. A bunch of Trump clips, a bunch of world news. It is a wild time to be alive. Briefly, you heard him plug it without me pushing him to do it. I didn't even know he was buying our products. I actually went and looked at our computer. Certainly enough, he's been buying the Liver Shield, a bunch of other stuff. So thank you for the support. Brain Force is one of the top nootropics out there. It's only been out 2 years. Third-party sites. We just take the best-known 10 ingredients and put them in there at a low price, high-quality organic. Go check it out for yourself. This is natural. This is healthy. I wouldn't take too many of these, though, or you'll bounce off the walls. It's amazing. Brain Force and your purchase supports the broadcast. InfoWarsLife.com. And we're running a 20% off on Lung Cleanse. That is upwards of 20 concentrated herbs and essential oils that just coats the larynx and the throat. Whether it's a sore throat or you've got, you know, issues with speech like I do sometimes from talking so much, you sign up for auto shipping, get 10% off. $50 off on orders or free shipping on $50 or more orders. I'm teleprompter free, folks. And 20% off right now on Lung Cleanse. It will sell out by Monday because the supplies are limited. But I do a special a few times a year when allergy season gets real bad. So Lung Cleanse available at InfoWarsLife.com right now. And it is your purchase, obviously, of these great products that makes the broadcast possible. Also, check out our great family of high-quality water filters at InfoWarsStore.com, Hillary for President's Church, and so much more, and help support the InfoWar. Roger Stone is our guest. By the way, he's such a trooper, and I'm not kissing his rear end here, but getting to know this guy. He was flying in at 11 last night because he had to work on stuff till 8, battling for this republic. Then, because of summer storms, the flight got bumped to 2:30 in the morning. What time did you land at Austin Bergstrom?
We actually ended up having to abort after waiting at the airport all night. We flew in this morning, making it by the skin of our teeth. So I spent the night in the Fort Lauderdale Hollywood Airport on my iPad.
Well, I tell you, you're amazing. So
happy to be here.
We want you to rest some this weekend, and you're flying out Saturday night because you're speaking Sunday at a Trump rally.
That's correct. I'm speaking to a Trump rally in Deerfield Beach on Sunday. There's about 400, 500 people expected, and I'm honored to be the main speaker, so I will be there.
Absolutely. Listen, you're going to break some big news, but we just tweeted it. I want to give people more time to tune in on the Chris Christie front because this is important. We're going to talk VP and a bunch of other issues. And I know you like to take questions. So I usually make folks hold for 30 minutes and then, you know, babble. We're going to take like 20 phone calls coming up at about 24 after when we come back in next hour at 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. We're opening the phones up, but for first-time callers for Roger Stone or witnesses to the social justice warriors going crazy, rampaging, and attacking free speech all over. So let's do that coming up at the start of the next hour on the Chris Christie front. On other issues, how is Donald Trump doing? He looks more energized than ever on television, and he's really taking the gloves off. Is that because, well, like he told us, because Hillary's been lying about him?
Well, first of all, I think he's enjoying California. Second of all, a number of people have said, well, why is he spending so much time in California? California's probably not one of the states up for grabs in the general election. Actually, I think his being there is brilliant. He's exacerbating the divisions between Bernie Sanders and Hillary, punching Hillary every day. He knows Sanders cannot be nominated, will not be nominated, although he is giving the Clinton folks fits. So he is out there pouring gasoline on that division with an eye towards winning a third of the
I was about to say, if I was advising Trump, I'd say live there to show the communists and people with foreign flags beating up women. Every time he does this, he just goes up in the polls.
Yeah, it has worked. So he's running a national campaign. He's not in California because California is necessarily in play, although I wouldn't write it off, not quite yet. But it's a national campaign. Doesn't matter where you are in the United States today because of mass media, your message is nationwide. It doesn't matter geographically where you are.
Wow. Obviously, Sanders will probably throw his weight behind Hillary. Do you think she might pick him as VP?
I think that's highly unlikely. Yesterday, it was interesting because, as you saw, Hillary attacked Trump about Trump University. Trump University is a real estate course that Trump sponsored. And as you may know, left-wing Attorney General Eric Schneiderman of New York has advanced this case because a small number of students at Trump University were dissatisfied with the results.
Doesn't it have like a 98% approval rating?
98% approval rating. Now, Schneiderman first met with Donald Trump and with his daughter Ivanka and tried to shake them down. In essence, said directly, if I got some big campaign contributions, I would drop this matter. Trump knew that was illegal and he declined. And
that was probably a setup too.
And Schneiderman has proceeded with the case. Here's the irony, and that is Trump University is nothing compared to a Clinton scandal entitled Laureate Education. Laureate Education was a what is a chain of universities, or I should say colleges and schools nationwide, was taken private by a friend of Bill, Stevie Cohen, turned out to be a financial disaster. So they brought in Bill
Hold
Clinton.
On, stay right there. We're going to come back and expose this scandal, then the Chris Christie thing. You're about to hear it here first, and so much more. Third hour, tell friends and family, neighbors, retweet. Folks need to tune in. This is important. Stay with us.
Visit GCNLive.com today.
StoneZone.com is this website, by the way. We are back live, ladies and gentlemen. I'm your host, Alex Jones. Roger Stone is our guest in studio. He tried for 12 hours to get her and finally got off the ground this morning and got to Austin, Texas. So he's here with us, StoneZone.com. In fact, they're in my office. Will somebody haul in both his new best-selling books on the Clintons and, of course, on the Bushes? Because this continuity is important to understand just how evil they are. This isn't tit-for-tat politically. The Clintons robbing foundations, robbing Haitian funds, you know, keeping most of the money, paying for their jets, their homes. These are horrible, nasty people, not just Benghazi or Emailgate. But you were just getting into this other university chain the Clintons are really involved in that is a scam. But listen, at least with real estate schools, you learn some real stuff, but you get out of it, you know, what you put into it. So sour grapes with leftist losers running around like the biggest story on earth is Donald Trump. Some people didn't like the classes they took. I mean, that's their problem. I am so sick of you. Meanwhile, mainline education is almost completely worthless now. You spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on it and learn how to be a social justice warrior. So tell us about this university scandal.
I have a piece up right now at Daily Caller about this. Laureate University is a Clinton scam. Basically, it was a failing chain of private schools. They paid Bill Clinton $16 million in 2010. They didn't disclose that until 2015. It was hidden. Clinton managed for them to get $150 million from the International Finance Corporation.
Good Lord.
They never qualified for their IPO. Clinton and the friends of Bill on Wall Street, KKR, Goldman Sachs, Stevie Cohen, they made a killing. The students didn't do so well. This pales in comparison to Trump University.
Well, this is unprecedented, $150 million. We're talking billions in this foundation of every scam you can imagine. Anybody else got that so-called money and then just took it would go to prison.
Yeah, this was a stunning interview you just did with my friend Peter Schweitzer, whose book is terrific and much of which is recapped with attribution in my book with some new information because I came and published several months after Peter. The Clinton Foundation is the largest single money laundering scheme in U.S. criminal history.
So they make Bernie Madoff look like a good boy.
A piker. This is a $2 billion global financial fraud. All of their filings with the individual states, with the IRS, by the way, the state attorney generals regulate charities. All of their filings are permeated with fraud and partial information. Why no Republican attorney general has yet opened an investigation into the Clinton Foundation is beyond me. Why the IRS is auditing Donald Trump's taxes, but not investigating the Clinton Foundation over which hundreds.
It's too big to fail.
Right.
I mean, they've got so many other people involved in the scam. They want to cover it up. But I mean, sorry, go ahead.
It's the Achilles heel, though. If there are three issues for Donald Trump, they're very simple. The Clintons' epic abuse of women, the fact that Bill sexually assaulted dozens of women and that Hillary then threatened and intimidated and bullied them into silence. Secondarily, her failure as Secretary of State, Benghazi, the email scandal, and our failed foreign policy. And then thirdly is the epic stealing by Bill, Hillary, and Chelsea, the way they have enriched themselves at the trough by trading governmental favors for giant speaking fees and contributions to their phony charity. 1, 2, 3. That's how you beat Hillary Clinton.
That is the 1, 2, 3 knockout crescendo or trifecta. When we return, the latest on the Chris Christie situation. You're about to hear it here first. The fall of Chris Christie. Why is this important? Well, we'll tell you straight ahead with breaking news with Roger Stone. I'm Alex Jones of InfoWars.com. Roger Stone is our guest, StoneZone.com, and he is here in Austin, Texas, to be in studio with us so the TV audience can also have the pleasure of him being with us. We're also going to talk campaign, talk Cleveland, talk the different strategies that are coming up there. StoneZone.com is his website, and I tell you, I know it's been Stone in there and others advising Trump, but Trump's his own man, to take the gloves off, go full bore, and absolutely, you know, attack the system. And whether it's 9/11 truth and the 28 pages, or whether it's the Clintons abusing women, or whether it is them selling out to foreign countries. I've seen Trump some lately talk about the communist Chinese and how Hillary gets money from them recently. But man, Laurel and Hughes, her and Bill, would allow the transfer of MERV technology, boost technology, re-entry technology that took a Chinese rocket program, because the Russians wouldn't give them ICBMs. Russia and China hate each other, you know, more than, you know, we think. In fact, more than China and Russia have issues
something,
with us.
Something Dick Nixon figured out. Go ahead.
Well, you're the expert. Yeah, well, tell us about that. And they, the Clintons gave, and there was almost an overthrow by the Pentagon of them at the time, by the way, gave them the Panama Canal, gave them most of our deep water ports, and gave them the missile secrets to destroy the United States. China could not do it. And talk about sick, and we're going to break the big news here. When I went and saw The Martian with the anti-gun creature, Matt Damon, in the movie, they say, thank God we don't have good technology, and the Russians don't either. Thank God our rockets are Chinese. Thank you for getting us to Mars and saving Matt Damon. I mean, inverted, and Politburos with red flags flapping. All this foreign money is controlling Hollywood, you name it, and now they have this EU commission, which runs things. It's a dictatorship saying we're going to have an internet ID. They're coming after the free speech. So we'll talk about that next, but just the history. You've got to promise sometime when you're not just battling, you know, for the Trump campaign, to the history with Nixon, all the stuff you saw. So just 60 seconds on Nixon, then we'll get into Chris Christie.
Well, I think you made an excellent point, which is Nixon figured out that the Russians and the Chinese could be played off against each other. That's how we got a SALT agreement to limit nuclear weapons. It's how we got the opening to China. They were more concerned about each other. This is the kind of president we need, somebody who puts America's interests first and figures out how to play our enemies off against each other. Now, let's go to the Christie situation. As you know, a federal judge has ruled that a list of unindicted co-conspirators in the George Washington bridge closing matter be released. Somebody calling himself John Doe has appealed to the court to try to block release of those documents. That hearing is coming up today, I believe. My sources, which are impeccable, tell me that there are, in fact, two lists. One is a list of unindicted co-conspirators. The other is a list of public officials who knew in advance that the bridge would be closed and did nothing about it. Sources at the very top tell me that Governor Chris Christie is on the latter list, which, of course, would be inconsistent with everything he has said publicly. So we need to watch that hearing very carefully. I think it is unlikely the judge is going to back off the release of these documents. And finally, the truth of Bridgegate will be known shortly.
Do we think John Doe may be a corpulent governor that resembles a hedgehog?
There were some who thought that was the case. I think it is not so. I think it is someone, however, who works for the governor, perhaps at the Port Authority, who would be on the latter list with the governor.
Will that hurt Trump because, you know, Chris Christie's a supporter?
You know, I think that the transference isn't really there. Obviously, Christie and Trump were competitors. Christie has been very supportive of Trump. He's been the one rhino Republican who has broken from the pack to come over from the never Trump crowd. But I don't think anybody realistically thinks he's on the list for vice president.
I don't want you to give out any, you know, intel, because you've got a great political brain, one of the best out there. It's admitted even by your enemies, of any Achilles heels for Trump. But obviously they've thought about every heel. They've attacked every heel they think's there. I think the only heel is Trump himself if he doesn't stay hardcore and backs off. But that's not his nature. But the assassination card, other issues, this media is willing to push any hoax. They've already filed fake lawsuits about, you know, underage girls he raped. That was totally fake and admitted. That tells me, though, I mean, nobody's invincible, and I know you're not saying that. What do you worry about on the belly of Trump? Are there any missing armored scales?
Yeah, look, I don't think so. Did he have gorgeous girlfriends in the period which he was not married? Absolutely. Did he play the field? Absolutely. There are no scandals. All this nonsense about David Brock and the folks at Media Matters America have reams and reams of unknown negative information. It's all crap. Here's the question. Why is the mainstream media asking about Trump University but not Laureate? Why are they asking Trump about how much he raised for veterans to the penny but not asking about the Clinton Foundation? You have a double standard. And Trump has taken it on frontally in his attacks last week on the media for raising the question about how much he raised for veterans. We know exactly what it is. 5.6 million, that's how much, with another 600,000 pledged and yet to be collected. In other words, the exact 6 million that Trump said it was months ago.
This
is a hit job.
They turn everything into something evil. He's at an event. He says, I have pledged from donors and myself $6 million. And then that's how pledging works, whether it's NPR or anything. Then you send the money. You call in and go, I pledge $500. They go, good. You get the coffee mug and the sweater. And then you write the check. He says, I have $6 million pledged. And they turn that into deceit.
Yes. Look, it is we're playing a game against a stacked deck. You're going to have a movement here, and I think everybody knows this, and Trump called it when he said it was rape. The women physically and sexually assaulted, raped, bitten by Bill Clinton, Kathleen Willey, Juanita Broderick, Paula Jones, Christy Zurcher, Sandra Allen James, Liz Ward Grayson, Eileen Wellstone, who may be found in Britain, the very first woman that Bill Clinton raped when he was at Oxford. They are going to be they're going to speak out. They're not going to be stifled and suppressed and threatened this time. And here's what will happen, Alex. There's going to be an attempt once again to discredit them. What do the Clintons always do? Attack the women. Attack the women.
But this time there's the internet and the new media that together is even more powerful than the whore media, the Brian Williams, Katie Couric, Decepticon media.
But they're going to say, oh, these women have been paid to say that. These women are ideologically motivated. These women are lying. No, folks, these women are telling the truth. They were browbeat. They were suppressed last time. They will not be.
I can see TV ads where it shows Hillary and Bill denying it. And then cut to Clinton going, I did not have sex with that woman, Monica Lewinsky.
Look, their credibility is shot, and that's their largest problem. Even liberals don't believe them. Nobody believes them. They have lied so many times about so many things.
Sure.
That attacking someone else is a liar.
So what happens? You know their brain. You know Brock. You know his rotting mind. What are they going to pull?
Look, they're running an old game plan. They have a completely programmed, scripted campaign. Sidney Blumenthal is petrified about the fact that Bernie is going to challenge them. Sidney Blumenthal is petrified about the fact that Cornel West is one of those who has been asked to second the nomination of Bernie Sanders, and therefore he's going to have a national audience to talk about the Clintons' record on civil rights, which is abysmal, to talk about their dog whistle politics. The fact that Bill Clinton once said to Ted Kennedy, you know, a few years ago, this boy Obama would be getting our bags and getting us coffee. So that's the real Bill Clinton, the Bill Clinton who signed Three Strikes You're Out. The reason so many young black Americans are incarcerated for possession of small amounts of drugs is so Bill Clinton could be looked tough going into his night.
And by the way, that's what's so crazy. They hang out with grand dragons. they really are the scuzzy end of the Dixie Mafia, literally. For folks that don't know what that is, I mean, I live here, okay, I know. And it's just crazy. You get around Dixie Mafia people, and I've been around them, and most of the top Democrats in town, I mean, they are the most racist people I've ever seen. And you're just like, it's like, what on earth? And then,
most African-Americans don't know the story of Ricky Ray Rector. Ricky Ray Rector was a retarded African-American man convicted in Arkansas. Hillary pushed Bill to execute him on the eve of the New Hampshire primary in 1992 so that they could look tough on law and order. Every African-American in this country needs to know the name of Ricky Ray Rector before this election.
And by the way, we're not just saying this. I don't just to win political points just say they're racist. I mean, the Clintons are anti-human scum. I mean, they are. Is there anybody worse than them except maybe Kim Jong-un?
Well, the Bushes are in the same league. I think the Bushes are actually a bigger criminals in terms of the overall.
Well, they got a lot of the Nazi money. That's why they're really a secret.
They start with Prescott Bush, the patriarch of the Bush family, the U.S. Senator.
They held the war chest for Hydra.
Yeah. He was basically financing the Third Reich's war machine.
Which was symbolized as a Hydra. That people think that's Captain America. I'm saying that's actually the group.
Yeah. It is. I think that, of course, the two families, the Bushes, and the Clintons, as you can see in both of these books, they're connected at the hip. It's one crime family. They're in it together, folks. That's why Bill says, George Bush says that Bill is like his brother, and that makes Bubba Hillary like his sister-in-law. And Barbara Bush.
Don't talk about Clinton. She's my son.
Yeah, she says that Bubba is the fourth Bush brother. God forbid.
Both the books, The Clinton's War on Women and Jeb and the Bush Crime Syndicate, are tour de forces. I thought I knew it all, and I read these books and couldn't put them down. Give these to your friends and family to really understand this is one of the crime families that have merged together ruling us, and the Bushes did it off stolen Nazi loot they got to keep. We'll be back. Tom in England, you're going to be up first, then Chris. Eric, is that Eric or Eric? My eyes are going. Jim, David, 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. We're going to be taking your calls for the balance of the hour, and then we're going to obviously be doing some tape shows and things here while Roger Stone is visiting in Austin, Texas. We're going to be doing some Facebook mentions and other viral videos. A lot of breaking news here in the next few days at InfoWars.com. I do want to go to your phone calls, but coming up in the next longer segment after we take some calls, Roger, you've got more to cover. Tell folks what it is.
Well, I want to talk about the convention. I want to talk about the way I see this playing out. And we should talk a little bit about the importance of the vice presidential nomination.
All right. We're going to talk about it all. Tom, in Her Britannic Majesty's Albion, you are on the air from jolly old England. Go ahead.
Thanks, Alex. I mean, Sir Alex, Lord Alex.
Thank you, sir.
And Roger. Hi, Roger. I've got a comment, a little sort of an anecdote, I suppose, and a couple of important questions for Roger.
Sure, go ahead.
So I was, this was a BBC documentary about 5-6 years ago. It was about reality TV, and there was a large segment on The Apprentice. And they interviewed a former contestant, and she was saying how great Trump was to work with, and how he was always jovial, smiling and everything. And she just told a story about how he came in jovial and smiling as usual, and then the producer told him the narrative. And the narrative was, Trump is in a terrible mood, something such and such happened, and blah, blah, on the way. And, and he apparently got into character, you know, like that. You know, it was
sure. I mean, he's been part of reality TV, and I can tell you, folks, it's almost all completely fake. Trump admits that. So here's your question is this just an actor we're seeing? And my answer, before you talk to the real insider, is it doesn't matter. This stuff he's doing is irrevocably damaging to the New World Order criminal project. That's why I'm supporting it. But I think he's gamed them. And I've talked to a lot of other insiders, and you didn't tell me this, that knew him years ago that said, look, Trump's more anti-New World Order than you are. He's just kept it secret, and he's like a sleeper cell. Is that an accurate statement, or is that?
I think he's had consistent views for 30, 40 years.
30 years ago, he was against NAFTA again.
Right. He was against NAFTA. He was suspicious of NATO and the fact that it's costing us a fortune and our allies are not paying their fair share. It made sense, perhaps, after World War II when we were wealthy and everybody else was broke. Now we're broke and everybody else is
wealthy. He's a businessman and he thinks about Team America.
But he's always thought that there is nothing new about his views. These have always been his views. He's always been an outsider. He's always scoffed at the inside Washington, New York elite. I can tell you this. He hated Washington. He hated going there. He hated the system.
They know that, by the way.
There's no question. So he hasn't changed. And no, I think the fellow you may have seen on The Apprentice may have been acting, but the Donald Trump you see on the campaign trail, that's the real Donald Trump.
Let me ask you this, Tom.
Forceful and to the point.
I kind of interrupted both of you, but is that your question? I was being presumptive, or is that it, Tom?
It wasn't really my... I mean, I've got other questions.
Go ahead.
But yeah, I was just going to say that not all of his views are consistent with what they were a few years ago. And in the context of him being an accomplished actor, I mean, I understand that Roger Stone says that what we're seeing now is the real Trump. What we're seeing then was an actor. But how do we know that? I mean, that's the thing. But I mean, my question to Roger Stone is: a few weeks ago, he said that in a certain state there was a million people who were fitted the profile of a Trump supporter. So my first question to him is, what is the sort of the social, what is that profile?
Okay, the real quick, the second one, because we got to go to break and get to calls here, sir. We've got some quick questions. Go ahead.
Yeah, look, I actually think this is a very important question, and I'll tell you why. The Trump voter can be analytically profiled. We know exactly who he and she are. And therefore, I think that one of the most important things that has to be done before this next election is the registration of 1 million new voters in the 10 swing states.
But I thought there's already been 2 million more voters that voted Republican than normally, 2.5,
but those are folks who are already registered and came to the process. They've just never voted in the primary before. I'm talking about registering 1 million
totally new
general election voters.
I think that's already happening. Let's talk about that when we come back. Tom, great questions. We only spend so much time. More callers straight ahead. We're going to go bam, bam, bam with your questions for Roger Stone. StoneZone.com. Get both his books, The Clinton's War on Women and Jeb and the Bush Crime Family, at InfoWarsStore.com, and support the broadcast while you get your Hillary for Prison shirt. I just love to see what Trump's doing. Roger Stone, I've been ranting here, but obviously I want to go back to calls. I want to know the essence of Trump, because obviously I'm not a lesser of two evils person, but the Democrats are going for broke here. They're annihilating free speech. They have people with Mexican flags all over California beating up women, beating up families. The mayors are on the news saying it's a great thing. This is real news, you know, mainstream news on InfoWars.com, with just bizarre statements by these people that I don't even call the left, because I'm, you know, what you'd call liberal on most issues, but I'm for free market, Second Amendment, and stuff like that, so I'm called this super right-wing extremist. No, I'm for free speech, so I'm the liberal. But they're so dangerous, they've got to be met, they've got to be resisted. It's so obvious that Trump is the only choice, and I think he should get 2-3 million new voters to come in and vote. And I think that is the initiative, reaching out to people of every race, color, and creed, and saying, you know you're being scammed. You know this is a fraud. Don't be intimidated. Go register to vote and go after them. My concern is, and I don't want to discourage folks, is election fraud. We just saw an Austrian nationalist 10 points ahead in every big poll, and then he loses to the Green Party socialist people that actually said in a campaign ad, liking Austria is bad, Austria sucks, in German. I'm not joking. So what is this leftist self-loathing mental illness, and how do we counter it? That's a lot of stuff, but that gestalt there, I'm supporting Trump because his enemies are so bad regardless, but I believe he is the real deal and will deliver.
I believe that in the last two presidential cycles, the Democrats have done a much, much better job of voter registration. The good news is, however, there are not a bunch of unregistered Democrats out there for them to bring in. Now, they can try to bring in illegals, and they have done that in some places. But the Republicans have not done a good job of voter registration.
Is that because of internal sabotage?
No, I think it's actually because there was no market. Now, with Donald Trump as the head of the party, now suddenly there is a market. There are at least 1 million people in the 10 key states willing to become Republicans because they've been drawn to the party by Trump. They weren't interested for Mitt Romney. They didn't even vote 4 years ago. Those people can be located through a sophisticated analytic and modeling program, and in the Floridas and Ohio's and Nevada's and Arizona's Pennsylvania and Florida, the key states, they can be brought to the polls.
And what about just people that are patriots of every race, color, and creed that aren't liberal or conservative, that are just common sense, saying, hey, I'm doubling down. I'm going to go out and find four or five of my friends that are liberal on some issues but aren't suicidal for the country, and I'm going to take them by the hand and go get them to register to vote.
Look, I'm working with a group called the Committee to Restore America's Greatness. That's all they're going to do is locate and register 1 million new Trump voters.
So that's the place to go to learn tips and what to do? Or to
be- we will be rolling this out shortly. The Trump campaign has not announced a massive voter registration drive. I think it's an absolute necessity as a political professional, as someone who's a veteran of 9 Republican presidential campaigns, starting with Nixon, through Reagan, Bob Dole, still doing penance for helping the Bushes. That's why I had to write the book. I can tell you this is the key to victory. That's how close this is going to be. It's the only hedge against vote stealing by the Clinton machine. So I'm going to be putting my back into voter registration. A goal, very simple, 1 million new Trump voters.
You could even call it something like red-blooded Americans. We're of every race, color, and creed. We love freedom, and we're for Trump. We're for the Republic, red-blooded Americans.
Yeah. Meanwhile, you've got the Never Trump operation. Now, this just continues to confound me. Look, Bill Kristol is a friend of mine. I like Bill Kristol. We don't agree on hardly anything. He really should get out of politics and stick to starting wars and writing, because he's a writer. Here's the point. You telling me that the conservative Republican members of Congress, the people who gave us an 80% increase in our $13 trillion debt, they're worrying about soiling themselves by endorsing Donald Trump? Please give me a break. Or those who say, oh, he's not a conservative. Well, what kind of conservative are they? The kind of conservatives like George W. Bush, who tells us Islam is a peaceful religion and who brought us into an endless war with no point, or Donald Trump, who says, let's find ISIS and destroy them? I know which kind of conservative I am.
And they don't want the wars here. They just want to keep them going forever. I talked to the special ops guys, Delta Force, you name it, the Marines, the Navy, all of them. They go, look, whenever they turn us loose, we wipe them all out. We have to sit there in bases and let them attack us.
Well, the idea of a third candidate, an independent candidate, who now turns out to be a writer at the Weekly Standard, this is some kind of fraternity joke. Here are your choices: Hillary, rotten Clinton, or Donald Trump. Those are your choices. Terrific piece today by Richard Viguerie, an old friend of mine, a real purist conservative, but who makes the case that for conservatives, this is the only choice. Trump is the only choice, and the Never Trump people need to get over it and get on board.
We've got more to cover about the VP and stuff, but let's go to the calls. Let's talk to Ben in California. He was at San Jose anti-free speech rally where a woman was beat up and the news said she deserved it. The mayor's like, you know, hit in the head with a Mexican flag and an egg in your face that cut it, get punched in the eye, a bleeding woman. And it's racially motivated. It's crazy. And, man, I love Hispanic people. That's not just like some you know, one-off. I mean, it's true. I like everybody, but I really like Hispanic folks, like the culture, the food, everything. I don't like how Mexico's degenerated into a narco-terrorist state and how the culture pushed by the media is gangbanger 18-year-old thugs who've been in and out of juvie hall running around beating up women. I mean, come on, folks. Are you really going to endorse a bunch of Mexican gangbangers beating up people? And I mean, come on, folks. I mean, don't people understand that that condoning this is going to create major division in this country, and that's why they're allowing this to happen and why they're endorsing it, is to create silent, cloistered, white, fearful racism so that then that we can all be managed as racial groups like prisoners. I mean that's my view. I mean, but it's going so far, and we're going to go to Ben.
I think it's a mistake. Here's why. Because at the end of the day, I think Hispanic voters care more about economic opportunity. They care about getting their piece of the American dream. They care about getting their piece of the economic pie. And the only person who's going to allow them to do that is Donald Trump. He's a job creator. He understands the economy. He's got a terrific tax reduction plan that is pro-growth and very dynamic. And at the end of the day, Hispanic Americans can choose between opportunity and prosperity and hate, because that's all they're churning out is hate.
Well, I'll say this. When Latin America was right-wing, it had some of the wealthiest countries in the world. And sure, they had some bad right-wing groups there, too, that they exacerbate. Oh, the right-wing killed 5,000 people. The communists will kill like 300,000 in countries when they take over in Latin America. You know, I'm not saying it's a lesser of two evils, but, I mean, free market is what makes things operate. It's all the countries that have it, even in limited form, are the ones that have jet airplanes and swimming pools and jobs and highways and a chance to get wealthy. You bring in collectivism, it's some kingpin who says he's a leftist in a red shirt sitting up in an armored compound while you live in a mud hut. Latin America could be this giant glowing jewel, and instead it's gone to hell in a handbasket, and the leftists just want to keep everybody down. I mean, that's, and people say, well, what about the left-right paradigm? It's been controlled because the right's been phony. But the establishment is going after humanity from a leftist perspective. I mean, look, Roger, you're involved in a lot of libertarian causes. I know you're involved in, you know, marijuana decriminalization. You have businesses in that. Oh, more power to you. You know, you're involved in a lot of stuff they call liberal. You know, you've gone after right-wing extremist candidates before yourself. I don't like that. I don't want monotheists telling me how to live, whether they're Christian or Muslim. So I really think it's about terms here. We are the classical liberals, the constitutionalists. We're the real progressives. These people are a cult of control freaks.
Yeah, I look at it in a slightly different way. At a certain juncture, I figured out that the left-right confrontation was really just a Hegelian device to distract us from the fact that there is an elite that is whose only interest is not ideological. They're neither left nor right.
They play both sides.
They're interested in control, power, and wealth. That's what they're interested in. And therefore, I probably have more in common with many Bernie Sanders supporters than I do with some traditional Republicans. The truth is, however, that this election is between the insiders and the outsiders. It's not between the Republicans and the Democrats like our past presidential elections. It's the Republicans and Democrats together versus Donald Trump and the people of the United States of America.
It's never been more naked, because it doesn't matter he's worth $8 billion. He's never been part of their club. He's always done it on his own. He's arrogant. He thinks he's smarter than them. Looks like he is. He's trying to come in and take over their whole pie. They don't know whether he's just taking it from them or is going to reform it. All they know is they've hijacked everything. They think it's theirs. And Trump's saying, no, it's not. Is that it?
Well, what did Newt Gingrich mean when he was asked why the Washington establishment so disliked Trump? And he said, well, he doesn't belong to the secret society. He's never taken the oath. He doesn't know the handshake. Now, maybe it was rhetorical.
It wasn't.
But maybe it wasn't. He's not part of the Council on Foreign Relations. He's not a member of the Trilateral Commission.
And there is a sexual and a cultic aspect to all these clubs. There's a political one. But to get in deeper, there's another level. Like the average gang says, go shoot an old lady to become a made member. When you get to Skull and Bones and stuff, no, you got to do something else to become a member, and it's sexual. Now, I'm going to leave it at that and go back to phone calls, but you're dead on. By the way, if you're a new viewer, let's find that. Newt Gingrich, Trump's never been part of the secret society. He said that on Fox News. It's not a joke. He really said that. So you're absolutely right. You crystallized it. This is really the end of an era. This is the fall of this corrupt group of insiders that have hijacked both parties. Trump realizes it's this moment in history. He's uncloaking as a patriot, making his move for nationalism to be George Washington Part Two. Is that accurate?
I think that's exactly right.
It's epic. Roger Stone's here with us. It's amazing. This guy, all the angles he's got. Ben in California, thanks for holding. You're on the air from San Jose. Go ahead.
How's it going, guys?
Good, brother. Go ahead.
Hey, I was just two things real quick. Me and my girlfriend, we're Mexican, and we attended the Trump rally. It is the most disgraceful, embarrassing thing I have ever seen in my life, man. There's people getting beat up, police not doing anything to help anyone. I got everything on camera. I'm telling you, man. And the mayor coming out and saying that Trump needs to be responsible for everything. And it's all crazy, man. The second thing I think that we need...
Take your time, because you're a witness to this, not just our cameras that are witnesses to what happened. Describe, as just a citizen of America, white, black, Hispanic, you're just a human, you want to go hear Trump speak, whether you support him or not, tell us if you do. Some people go just to hear and they get beat up, So what was it like? What did you see?
Okay, first of all, I'm a libertarian, and I just support a lot of what he says. But as we stepped out, there was just total chaos. I mean, everyone was just talking mess to the Trump supporters, calling everyone racist. I mean, everything.
We're going to show some B-roll of that in the background. Tell us what you witnessed.
I just saw, I mean, we started walking to my car. I was with my two-year-old son. And, I mean, we were just walking. I was recording everything. People were just talking mess to everyone. And then out of nowhere, some guy got his Trump hat ripped off, some older white male, and they just started beating him. And I told my girlfriend just to go to the car, and I just wanted to stay there and record everything. And the police weren't even helping this man. I was screaming at the police to help him. I have everything on camera right there. I was screaming at the police to help this man, literally five feet in front of the police. They were not helping this man. There was like 20 cops, and they were just staring at me. And this guy was just getting beat. And then I seen that happen like three other times because I stayed the whole night to record everything. And the police were not helping anything. I don't know what the hell happened. This looked exactly like what happened in Baltimore. I mean, this is crazy right now, man. And
God, they just sucker punched that guy. Well, sir, let me tell you this. I want to get your information. Do you have a YouTube channel? Because if you have this footage, police stand by during racial attack, it should go viral. We need to expose this. This is crazy. And I've got to say, at a certain point, the Second Amendment's going to come involved here. When people are being attacked, this is just amazing. So have you put your footage out yet, sir?
No, I have not. But my second thing I was going to say, I think that we need a whole bunch of constitutionalists to go out, because I was literally the only one of the only males out there that was trying to help these people getting beat up. I was trying to grab these people and get them away from all these crazy people. There's no one out there to help these people. I mean, I think we need a whole bunch of Trump supporters or people that support the Constitution to go out there and protect these people, because these people are just,
yep.
I mean, this young boy had a Trump sign, and they ripped it up, and he was just screaming at them like, this is my opinion. You guys are calling me racist. Like, I'm not even doing anything to you guys. I mean, I think we need people out there to protect these people, man. Like, everyone that could conceal carry permits, anything, bring out a legal knife. I mean, if these people want to do something stupid, man, it's going to be on them. And
Here's the thing, sir. I hear you. The media is trying to spin this and trying to cover this up, and it's just out of control. The communists just want to have some giant civil war. And I look at our military, who on average, some of the most, you talk to top special forces people I know, and they just tell me, hands down, on average, you know, Hispanic Americans are the toughest, hardest fighting, smartest people we've got for this country. And then you've got these communist scum, brainwashed teenagers out here racially attacking white people because they have USA on their shirt. It is just a shame. And I hear you. If I was Hispanic, I would be ashamed of this. I'm ashamed of this as an America. But sir, please get your, I'm going to put you on hold. We'll be overnight at FedEx, whatever. But everybody that's listening that videotapes this stuff, need to get it up. Do you have a YouTube channel? Can you get this out?
Yeah, I could put it up on my YouTube channel.
What is your YouTube channel? And we'll link to it as soon as you put it up.
Well, I just have a YouTube account. And I don't have an actual channel, but I can make a channel and I can send you guys.
I'm going to put you on hold. I'm going to have most of my crews on vacation right now. I'm going to have Darren McBreen get your number from John Harmon, and then we're going to call you in 10 minutes and work through this with you and get this footage uploaded and get it out, okay?
Yes, sir.
God bless you, Ben. Go ahead, Roger.
Look, we should not be surprised that the Clintons are using thug tactics. They've used thug tactics their entire career. These are people who used Arkansas state troopers to have witnesses to their corruption and their sexual crimes beaten, who broke into people's houses, who burned people's houses down, drove people out of the country for fear of their lives, broke into people's cars, smashed their windshields, slashed their tires, killed their pets, threatened their children, threatened their children's friends. The Clintons are thugs. They are worse than the mafia.
The bullying's over, though, and Donald Trump's the spearhead, like on an icebreaker. We're the ship. He's that big iron steel, you know, spike ramming through the ice. Is that it?
That's why they're so apoplectic, because in a guy, they can't co-opt him. They can't silence him. This is like stepping in front of a moving freight train. The day of reckoning is coming, and Donald Trump is going to be the man who brings it.
You know, throughout history, criminals, whether they're the communists, the Nazis, they always think they can overrun everybody. And at first they have victory, and they push, and all of a sudden, the sleeping giant awakens. And I can feel the sleeping giant isn't just awake now. It's awake, and it's pissed.
Look, I've been through 9 presidential campaigns. I have never seen anything like this. Reagan was as close as we got, but this is a real grassroots insurgency. I've never seen anything like it. You don't have to call the Trump people to show up. They show up on their own. You don't have to call them to remind them to vote. They show up to vote. I've never seen this kind of grassroots power.
If somebody just thinks they're going to punch me, I can't believe these folks don't fight back, though. But I guess they're smart like Gandhi.
Well, look, I actually think, look, I'm against violence because any kind of violence will be blamed on Trump, no matter who started
it. No, I get it. If I fight back, I'll be blamed.
So, sadly, you have to turn the other cheek. You have to avoid violence.
I agree. Like Christ, not that Christ was a wimp. It was so manly to take it to show how bad they were.
Again.
So, at a certain point, I guess you just absolutely show they did it by not fighting back. I've never done that in my
violence
life.
Violence is not the answer. It will not solve the problem. But the mainstream media will blame it on us.
I've just never let somebody punch me and not get punched back. I don't know how to do it, but I hear you.
Well, either does Trump, I assure you.
I love when they jump the stage trying to attack him. He doesn't run. He just pushes his Secret Service office ready to punch him.
Look, Donald Trump's taking his life in his hands. Every day goes out on the campaign.
I can tell he loves it, doesn't he?
He's not afraid. He's not living in fear. He's having the time of his life. And he's correct. This is not a political campaign. It's a movement. It's a movement to save America. And he's willing to risk his life for it. I just sent $1,000 to the Committee for American Sovereignty, one of the super PACs is supporting Trump that I do believe in, that unlike Great America PAC is not a ripoff.
Let's run by Benton the Felon, right?
Yes, correct. Look, you've got Hillary Clinton sitting on $48 million in super PAC funds. And that money, it was 80. She can raise much more. It is unlimited in terms of what she can get. We have to have these same groups. We have no choice.
I'm just looking at that camera over there to the audience and just telling them, this is an epic time to be alive. I don't care what stinking color you are. We're all red-blooded. And I've always had this idea about, our color is red and taking the color red back from the communists and saying, you don't run the color red. Humanity, that's our color. That's our blood. The communists admit they love red to show red terror. They're going to kill everybody. Well, I got news for the reds. We're bringing red back, meaning you're the ones that are going to get run over if you try to enslave us. This is the Republic of the United States of America. We are not going to die easy and go down without a fight, Roger Stone.
Well, what I'm saying is, never mind the red, you're not going to win this election without green.
That's right.
And therefore, yesterday's announcement that Tom Barrack, who is an L.A.-based, very close friend of Donald Trump's, runs a very successful real estate opportunity fund. He has started a super PAC. He's got an immediate $37 million in solid pledges from Trump supporters. That is a pivotal moment. The Committee for American Sovereignty.
So is the momentum building? I feel
yes, and there's going to be a number of worthy groups, real groups, not ripoff groups like Great America PAC, the Ed Rollins, Jesse Benton operation. Ed Rollins, longtime Republican operative, works for Teneo Strategies today. That means he works for the Clintons, and his PAC, Great America, is a front. It's a scam.
I want to talk. I got to get calls. All this is golden. We got to do more interviews. Obviously, you're going to let us. I know you have no sleep waiting for your flight here, but we can do some more interviews and stuff for Sunday, right?
Yes.
Good. So there's been more Roger Stone, more exclusive here. I want to go to some phone calls right now. We'll do 5 more minutes in the next hour, and then we can go get some lunch here, and then we can who is it taking over in the fourth hour today? That's going to be Anthony Gucciardi doing a great job. But before we do that, please buy the products at InfoWarsStore.com. I've skipped like 3 breaks today, which nobody else in the industry does. That's like $1,000 a minute we're losing. I can't help it. But just buy the products at InfoWarsStore.com. We got 20% off Survival Shield, 20% off the Lung Cleanse. We've got all these different specials that are running right now. We will sell out of Lung Cleanse by Monday, so take advantage of this 20% off. We have the new Revolutionary Air Purifier that is available at 25% off out of the gates. That's Alexa Pure Breeze that is way, way, way lower than any other competition. There's no reviews yet because it's brand new, but I've been using it here at the office for a few months. I'm about to get some of my home. They are simply amazing. They just came out, but I have one of the prototypes. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com for the nutraceuticals, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And whatever you do, because it's so much fun, it's gone from 1 in 25 Trump supporters on average at the rallies to 1 in 10. Now we're going for 1 in 5, where Hillary for Prison shirts are just everywhere, lining the front row. It's making huge news. It's amazing. InfoWarsStore.com with a 4.9-star review out of a possible 5. That's a 99% star. So please take advantage of that today and the small profit we make funds this operation. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com, or toll-free 888-253-3139. Let's go ahead and talk to Chris in Georgia, then we'll go to Erica in Oregon and others. Go ahead.
Hello, Alice and Roger Stone.
Go ahead. Thank you.
All right. I have three questions, but I'm going to ask my first for now. If you have time, I'll ask the other one. I don't think Trump will be president because I believe the elite will kill him. Do you agree? I mean, I support him, but do you see him as president, given all the dangers he's been through? I mean, all the tweets and death threats and the little protection and safety.
Well, I mean, look, there's no doubt he's one of the bravest men ever alive in American politics. You know, he's not George Washington yet, but he's trying. So, yes, they want to kill him. They're openly. Glenn Beck's been suspended off SiriusXM. He's being, because he does these little premeditated somebody needs to kill Trump things. I'm not attacking Beck, but it's getting crazy. The New York Times says kill him. They're allowing this. Facebook allows hundreds of pages calling for his death for months. Roger Stone, this guy's got a good point. Chris's got a good point.
Yeah, no, I think it's a very legitimate concern. Look, I have been banned on CNN because my views are politically incorrect. But a fellow named Wilson, a Republican consultant from Florida, he tweets out, somebody needs to put a bullet in Donald Trump. He still appears regularly on CNN. So once again, you see the double standard.
Yeah, somebody's put handcuffs on his ass.
Yeah, well, at least he had to get a visit from the Secret Service.
He doesn't have a right to say, as a media person, go kill somebody. Listen, if I got up on air and told my listeners, I got to know, they're great people, but the small percentage are crazy. If I said go kill somebody, they'd try. And Glenn Beck knows that. It's not like he's an average guy saying somebody should put a bullet in him. He knows damn well he's got enough lunatics listening, they'll go out and try it. I'm sorry, Roger.
Look, I don't disagree. So let's come back to your question because it's crucial. Who the vice president is the central question. I think Trump's greatest insurance policy against assassination is picking a vice president whose views are almost identical.
More to hardcore. Don't have a George Herbert Walker.
No, because then that's an open invitation. Whether it's Lyndon Johnson, whether it's George Bush, that's an open invitation for a
Roger time. Stone is on fire despite the fact he was stuck in an airport with summer storms all night with no sleep. He's here fighting for the Republic. Fourth hour straight ahead. Infowars.com/show for free feeds. Chris, thanks for the call. Other callers, stay with us. By the way, I'm just going to say this. Roger Stone's got to take a break right here. He didn't want me to talk about this, but we're going to just say it. He flew here even though his mother just got out of the hospital to basically come home. Well, you want to repeat what you just said, then maybe come back.
My mother's gravely ill, and she is. There's nothing more that Western medicine can do for her. She's had the last rites, but she is not. Her passing was not supposed to be imminent, so the doctors gave me permission to come here today. I'm flying back tomorrow, but it's a very hard time. By the way, my mother, a hardcore Donald Trump supporter, and I hope she can make it to November.
Absolutely. I know you want to get into that, but it just shows how no sleep to get here, your mom's, you know, at home, and your wife's calling saying emergency call. So listen, I know we said we'd take more calls, but why don't you just go ahead and take a break? We're going to do some more taping later. I can take these calls right now. I'll see you in there in the conference room. Go ahead and go
Great. Take
that call right now.
Many thanks.
All right. Thank you, sir. All right. Yeah, there goes Roger Stone. Because that's real. He kind of needed to get off right there. And then that was a 60-second break at the end of the hour. So that kind of just happened right now. So he's got to go off air. Sorry to the callers. You got to talk to me now. But we will tape some more stuff for other broadcasts, obviously, coming up Sunday. Is that Eric or Erica? It's like so many lights in my eyes. I can't read. It's Eric. Okay. In Oregon, you're on the air. Go ahead. Welcome.
Hi, Alex. I'd like to say to Roger, thoughts and prayers are with him. It's a rough time for him, but I appreciate everything he's doing.
Well, he's a hard fighter. That guy, like, sends me texts at 6 a.m. and 3 a.m. And we have conversations at 2 a.m. sometimes. It's crazy, I tell you. He's definitely dedicated.
That's a fantastic person. Now, as far as the media goes and Donald Trump calling him out, I support him 100%. After everything that went on up here in Oregon with the constitutionalists trying to get their word out, trying to get, you know, the ranches taken care of, whether you agree with what they did and how they did it or not, they're all in prison. It was a political setup. Harry Reid and Hillary Clinton, they've had their hands in this for years. Now, they're all in prison, and not one of them ever committed any violence towards another person. Yet, we've got all these groups down here attacking people. We had FBI, police, everything crawling in this little town of Burns. But you go down there and you watch what's going on at the Trump rallies, and the officers are standing back with their hands behind their back.
That's right.
And the meat.
The Soros funding groups are pledged to kill police, and the police cowardly, I'll say it in some jurisdictions, not their enemy, but I mean, coward's coward. They follow their orders, and they always say, well, it's my order. Well, you know what? I didn't follow orders to shut up and go along when people attacked me and went after me, and the system said, shut up or we'll kill you. So I'm just sick of all these men. Like, people go, well, George Soros would have been put in a concentration camp if he didn't help round up his fellow Jews. I've had Hollywood people tell me, listen, we like you, but you shouldn't knock George Soros. He had to do it. And I'm like, you told me round up innocent people or I'm going to be dead? I'll tell you, put the bullet in me. I better be chained up when you say it or I'm going to try to kill you. And people go, oh, God, you're going to fight back? Yeah, I'm going to fight back. But since when do people not fight back? I just can't understand it. I just don't get it. People go, man, you're like really tough. You want to fight these people. My ancestors were probably five times tougher than I am. I cannot believe that we've lost our soul. That's all I'm trying to say here. Erica, anything else?
What happened up here in Oregon? These are political prisoners now. That is the only reason why they're in prison.
No, I agree. I mean, Pete Santilli lied about me and did a lot of horrible stuff to me, but he doesn't deserve to be locked up for months for running around doing what he was doing. I think it's dangerous to the entire press and especially the other people there. Just, they should not be in jail. So many people come to me and say, hey, you know, this talk show host used to bash you. Aren't you glad he's locked up in prison? And I say, well, you'll be next. No, I'm not glad. I'm not glad he's locked up in prison. These people, though, they just don't realize how serious this is. They think this is a game. And this is not a game, ladies and gentlemen. We're not playing a game here. We're going to come right back with Anthony Gucciardi. Stay with us. I'm going to come as well. Stay with us. I tell you, that was not theatrical on purpose. His mother's been taken out of the hospital, basically ready for hospice. And he talks about his mom all the time when he's here visiting and stuff. Old Italian lady, 90-something years old. And he said that... he looked at his phone and got tears in his eyes, and we were going live on air, and he said, my mom, she was dying, and that's why we had to get him off air, because we were on air, and he was there with a smartphone, you know, having to go find out what's going on with his mom. So that's why Roger Stone's not here. So I'm sure the callers will be okay, like David and Jim and Rob and Michael and Joseph that have been holding. Anthony Gucciardi is going to be taking your calls. He's got a bunch of news. They've got a boil down of my report on the attack on free speech by the EU with Internet ID coming up. We've got a lot more here. We didn't get to Hillary Clinton's foreign policy Trump attack, where she says Trump like 60 times. John Kerry slams Trump. These are the people that run Al-Qaeda and ISIS and are destroying our country, saying Trump doesn't know foreign policy. He's got the common sense not to start wars with Russia when Russia has three military bases. Is on the verge of collapse. We don't want Russia to collapse. We'll collapse too then. That's what causes global depressions. But they have this weird sicko view that if somebody else collapses, we do good. Yes, if Russia and China are expansionists in the 60s and menacing us, if we can play them off against each other, do it. But you don't go mess with people that are just trying to survive. Well, the answer is we'll put George Soros in charge of Russia and teach five-year-olds how to be gay. No, we're not going to push your pedophile agenda. Sorry. So we're going to get to those clips in this hour and a lot more. Anthony Gucciardi, loaded phones here. I skip probably four or five breaks today, and this is not a gimmick. I've got to stop because they come to me, the accountant, some months ago. You know, you lost money this month. You got to stop that. The network puts up with it. Everybody does. Affiliates can't believe it because they don't care. They've got the local breaks. They're like, wow, you really skip half your breaks. It's got to stop. Kind of added a fourth hour because I just need more time here. Because once you start talking about this, it's hard to shut up. But just know this. We need your financial support. InfoWarsStore.com. We have a new air filtration system that in the specs, comparable units of the lowest price are $400 to $500. Some are close to $1,000. I bought units with specs the same 2 years ago that I have in every room of my house. I have like five of these. And not in the bathrooms, obviously, but all the main rooms. And they were $1,000 a piece, like $980-something bucks a piece, over $1,000 with tax. This sucker has four filters. It's ionic cluster technology and a bunch of other systems. We've got four filters. and it's $184. That's 26.02% off, and then an introductory offer. It will have to end on Monday. And we have 20% off on lung cleanse that's off until Monday, because it's going to sell out maybe before Monday. In fact, I should say until it sells out, because we already had pre-programmed over a year ago in the shopping cart to once a year, you know, in between spring and summer, to offer this when the pollen's real bad. And they said, hey, Alex, why are you doing this special? We only got like 1,000 bottles of it. I'm like, sorry. That's available. You really should try it when you have an itchy throat or whatever. I'm like, I had really bad itchy throat the last month because of allergies. I said, I'm like Hillary Clinton coughing. I said, wait, lung cleanse. Psh, goes away. So incredible. So InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. But Anthony Gucciardi, tell us what you've got coming up today on these phone calls you're going to be taking.
You know, yesterday when you went on the show and you had Kit on, you talked about EU proposes government ID to use internet.
That's on Drudge right
it
now.
It was so absurd that most people said, okay, you know, I know you guys cover credible stuff, but it sounds crazy. So what Darren did is he went in and put all the articles, all the information into like a 5-minute clip of just information overload. So we're going to premiere that. And then also we've got Biggs. He was going to come on the bottom of the hour, but he says he's live right now in the media hub at the Trump rally in Reading.
And that links up on InfoWars.com. And we should tweet that out too.
Yep. So he's about to come on live here on the fourth hour when we come back. Or actually, depends when we stop, but he said he's in it right now. He's got a live stream going.
Well, let's go to it. We have that stream up right now.
I'll see if we can pull him up.
We take you now live to Klandathu?
Yeah, we're going to Klandathu.
Yeah, it's not really started yet. I'll never forget, I walked into Charlie Sheen's house like 12 years ago, and there's Denise Richards back in her prime, and I said, we now take you live to Klandathu. That actually happened.
Do what? What's your name? Joe Biggs?
Who's this guy talking to Joe?
How you doing?
Oh, it's listeners. That's awesome.
Oh, right on. Thanks.
Well, I know he has some interesting interactions before this that he wants to talk about.
We're going to go to Joe in a minute. I'm going to let you do that. We got calls, everything else. Well, what do you make, though, just of the crazy climate and the image of people with Mexican flags beating a woman and people up in the media? The mayor of San Jose says this is good.
You know, I was in the break room before the show. I was getting a water. And on the news, they said, well, we know there's been countless reports of Trump supporters attacking, spitting on, and harassing Clinton supporters. And I was just thinking, what? I mean, it is hilarious. And you don't even have to be a rabid Trump supporter or anything to realize, wait a minute, this is totally insane.
And these crooks have taken over, and they just think because they have platforms they can spew BS. They're self-immolating themselves.
What's
the mainstream
nowhere.
Media is burning itself up.
They're talking right into the trash can.
Oh, man.
It's the put it in the nice way, right?
That's the PG version. Oh, they're talking into Hillary Clinton's horse ass. Let me ask you this, Andy.
That's PG, too. That's acceptable.
It's acceptable. Yes. Hillary said so. Yes. Where do you think all this is going, though? Because this is a crazy time to be alive.
Well, I think that more people realize what's going on than we think. I mean, look at the... Look at the reaction to something like Roger Stone doing the AMA on Reddit or Paul Watson last night. People freaking out, super excited about it. And then you look at the reaction to like the Redskins thing. They did that poll where the Washington Redskins, they went and polled real Native Americans.
And it was something like 70-something percent, right?
96%, so they weren't offended. 96%.
I went from memory, yeah. 96% of Native Americans. Because it's obviously honoring them. So, yeah. Oh, there's a Hillary for Prison shirt, Patriots. That's an original one.
And maybe it is politically correct, but they don't care. So they just make all these issues out of nothing, freak out about it, when the actual base of the people they're claiming are being hated on and are so upset don't even care. So there's just all a, we'll start to find a PG way of saying this too, patting each other on the back, right? So in a big circle. So basically what they're doing is they're making
just
a big storm out of nothing. They're participating in a circle jerk. And no one on the outside actually cares. Not even the people they claim do. It's all a big joke. It's all a big facade.
So the facade is coming down. The end of an era is here.
Yes.
I think Hillary may just detonate nukes. Obama just might go, Earth's blown up. Screw it.
Hey, all else fails, right? All else fails. Why not? The codes were 00000. It's not that hard to figure out.
Yeah.
Liberal. This is the real audio. ladies and gentlemen.
This is real Obama this morning. I am ready to kill the infidel pig maggots. Prepare the nuclear weapons. The planet will be destroyed for all.
I would imagine it with a Palpatine hood. You do a pretty good Palpatine, too, actually.
Anyways, let's go to this clip. We have a crooked Hillary supercut of Trump I'm going to play first. So let's play it right now. Here it is.
Hillary Clinton has to go to jail, okay? She has to go to jail. Has to go.
Listen to this one. Hillary Clinton, when she was Secretary of State, ran up $1 trillion in trade deficits with China. $1 trillion. Great job, Hillary.
By the way, Hillary Clinton is missing 30,000 emails. They've been deleted. 30,000. 30,000 emails.
Crooked Hillary, crooked, crooked Hillary. She's a crooked person.
Remember, Hillary Clinton used to hate Obama. She used to hate him. Bill Clinton hated him. He called Bill Clinton a racist. Do you remember that?
Come on, try getting it out.
At the same time, Secretary Clinton was surrendering our jobs to China. The Chinese government and its supporters were funneling huge sums of money to Bill Clinton so that he gives speeches.
Chinese would never do this themselves.
He's giving China all these deals, and China's paying him vast amounts of money to make speeches. Great job. Great job. I'm sure they never discussed it. I'm sure it had nothing. I'm sure it was just a coincidence. Folks, when are you going to get? These are crooked people.
Hillary Clinton has to go to jail, okay? She has to go to jail. Has to go. The only reason she's behaving like this, and the only reason she's been dragged so far left, believe me, is she doesn't want to go to jail over the emails, okay? Believe me, that's the only reason. She's guilty as hell.
These are crooked people. They've been crooked from the beginning. They were crooked with Whitewater. They've been crooked from the beginning. You look at that foundation. It's pure theft and pure
God, this is real politics. He's savaging her.
Do you believe he's saying this?
This is history, folks. Trump is the golden toad god. I'm loving this. Anthony, we're going to skip this break. I'm going to turn it over to you and take phone calls. Joe Biggs is out there. All I can say
is... Skipping the break again. Look at you, man.
Listen, I'm telling you, Trump is higher than a kite off of the adrenaline. He gets the zeitgeist he's in the middle of. It is like a fountain of flame to watch this happen. The system is crap. That's why Obama and suddenly Hillary go on TV and they go, because like their hoax is falling. The whole illusion is dropping. This is insane, Anthony.
I just can't believe he's saying this. I can't believe he's going that far. He's saying he does not
care.
Dude,
he listens. You know the whole thing. He's a patriot. The truth is Trump's been waiting the whole time. He's got him. He knows it, and he wants to burn him.
I know. And he's
like putting Hillary on a hot dog, you know, a coat hanger, putting him over a flame. And like Hillary's like sputtering and bloating and popping and juices dripping out. And
this is very descriptive. This is poetic.
No, can you imagine Hillary's a hot dog over a flame?
I think she's looking quite similar right now. But imagine what his people must have been thinking.
A long time.
There it is.
Anyways, all right, I'm going to stop. I'll make it off air. Go ahead and have fun. Go ahead and take over.
You can't just leave on that note. You can't just leave.
I'm leaving. I got to go.
All right. Well, I'm going to take over now. Now, I guess all the fun part is over now. We're going to have to talk about articles. But I can't believe that Trump is even saying that stuff. Can you imagine what his advisors in the beginning were saying? Like, you can't say that. That's going to offend people. It's going to freak people out. But it's just like the Redskins, the Washington Redskins. If they're even Washington Redskins, I don't watch sports. I don't know what state it is, but I think it's Washington. 96% of Native Americans that were polled said they don't care. They're not offended by the name. But everybody was in a huge hoorah about how offensive it was. Now it's going to make people so mad they need to change their name. They're going to lose all their money. They're going to lose all their fans. But in reality, no one cared. And this is the best part. You don't even have to be a Trump supporter to realize the power of going out and talking about stuff that and not having to sit back and be afraid of things like political correctness. And it reminds me of this story, too. And we're going to go to Biggs here in a minute because he's got a lot to say. But reminds me of this. Texas student not allowed to wear Honor Society ribbon to avoid hurt feelings. So what level are we going to go to? What depth are we going to go to? Let's say we just keep getting deeper and deeper and deeper until the pressure of the ridiculous political correctness domination just starts cracking your bones. What depth are you going to get to? Because we don't have a submarine. A high school in Plano, Texas is denying National Honor Society members the right to wear the NHS emblem on white stoles for graduation. The reason given, says one mother, graduates may not wear any club or organizational regalia and they cannot single out students. Said she, Kellyanne Frederick said she was told by a National Honor Society sponsor that school officials wanted everyone to feel included on graduation day. She was told that school administrators did not want to single out any students. So, Honor Society, you know, you have great grades and you're in honor roll classes and you're awesome, right? You get to wear a badge about how you did well and you performed well in school. Not allowed to do that because that could hurt other people's feelings. That could make them sad, the people that are not in honor roll. So now we have to worry about making everyone feel included. You're not allowed to distinguish yourself. And to draw a parallel from that, well, then if I'm wearing this blue shirt and someone else is wearing a different colored shirt, I don't want to single them out. If I'm wearing nice things, if I have nice clothes, that could hurt someone's feelings because they don't have nice clothes or they don't have a nice haircut. So therefore, by the same logic, you should not be able to wear anything nice. We should all wear prison outfits so that everyone else feels comfortable. And anything you say, you could, using big words, could offend someone. It could really, really hurt them. So if I'm using a big scary word, through study of vocabulary, through study of the English language, through love of the English language, through broadcasting talent or whatever, I'm actually singling other people out because they may not have the same vocabulary as me, and therefore that is bad. So by the same logic that you're not allowed to wear something that you've achieved, I guess Purple Hearts are bad too. We should ban Purple Hearts in the military. We should ban rankings in the military. Actually, let's talk to Biggs about that, too. We should ban rankings in the military because even though he might be a former staff sergeant, which means he's had more time in the military, more training, more ability to lead, that's singling out the privates that just started one day ago and making them not feel included and wanted. So I think we should get rid of ranks and everyone should do what they want. Let's pull Biggs on. He's out in Redding, California, I believe it is. And he's at a Trump rally and he said some crazy stuff is going on there. He's in the media booth, so he's going to show us a little pan. But first, Joe, I want to ask you, what do you think? Based on this, Texas students not allowed to wear the fact that they're an honor roll student. Do you think we should just get rid of all rankings in the military?
No, I don't think we should. But I fear that it will come to that point because we're such a nation of people that are so easily offended and we have leadership that allows that kind of action to be coddled and we promote it instead of going, hey, grow up. If you want to be a staff sergeant in the military, work hard, keep your nose clean, don't get in trouble.
And the CEO should be the same as any employee in the company. Everyone should have the same ability if we're going to offend people. Even though no one cares, no one's actually offended, it helps people achieve things. You think that's good?
No, it's completely, totally ridiculous.
So, all right, well, tell us where you are. We're just having a little fun.
All right, so
tell us what's going on.
We're in Redding, California. They're actually bringing up the little stairway for Trump. He's about to land and get out and speak. There are tons of people here. There are zero protesters in this area at all. Like, there's no protesters. There's a lot of people with Hillary for Prison t-shirts on, though, I'll tell you that. Here comes one right here. Just happens to be walking
they
by.
They are in the ward. God bless you.
Thank you, sir.
God bless everything you guys do. We're the Northern California State Militia.
All right, cool, thanks.
Yes, sir. I'm a Trump fan, baby, all the way.
All right, we're live.
Too bad we couldn't get Ted Nugent as a VP. And
hey, so Joe, tell us, tell those people we're live on air and they're awesome. But
yeah, we're live.
Tell me what you've been seeing today. You said you heard you saw some crazy things earlier and some protests you wanted to talk about.
Yeah, there was no protest going on here at all. Everyone says this is Jefferson County. They said they pretty much seceded from the rest of California. And our patriotic conservatives who love America, they love Trump, And, you know, this event just now kicked off with the Pledge of Allegiance. You know, there's no Mexican flags waving. And if you actually see, there's a giant, large, ooh, look at that. Look at that big flag.
Okay, so like I understand what's happening. They were saying the craziness is that there's not rabid protests. That's what they were saying. This fill me in. The craziness is that there was no crazy protests at this event, which is a phenomenon. So what's going on?
Yeah, zero protests. Everyone here is happy. No one's waving American or Mexican flags. There's tons of American flags. There's peaceful gatherings. There's people out here that are patriotic that want to come out here and, you know, have a good time together, hear Donald Trump speak. So it's not like you saw San Jose where people were being assaulted, you know, punched, spit at, you know, eggs thrown at them, you know, the cars kicked in. You know, you're not going to see that in this kind of area from what everyone's here telling me. They said these people protested would know not to come around this area.
What's the media going to do about that? They're not going to like that. There's nothing bad going on.
I'm sure they'll find some kind of way to spin it. They always do.
Well, you know what they're going to do.
We got the Communist News Network behind us anyway, so I'm sure they'll find a way to paint it bad. Well, somebody will trip and fall, and it'll be white privilege that did it.
Well, you know, I'll tell you what. If the media wants to make something look bad, they just show the craziest people at any event. They've done it time and time again. I've been to events. They just interview the craziest people there that are actually insane. And then they say, we went to such and such event today, and here's some of the people we talked to. And it's like, I believe that Neptune is coming to collide with the United States, and that they're going to save us. And it's like totally insane people. And then they say, these are the kind of people we interviewed at the rally. And then they'll have like one reasonable person at the end. It's amazing. We've all seen also the media photos where it's like a picture from a weird angle and it shows like there's a million people at this rally. And then they zoom back later on Twitter. Someone posts and there's like 20 people. It's all angles. Everything can be made to look like something at one point
night,
or another.
Last night when
go ahead.
Last night when I was at the free speech event, the Milo thing in UC Irvine, there were protesters standing out front screaming, you know, F the police, this and that, blah, blah, blah. And then they push a guy, and this guy gets mad and pushes back, and then they call for the police to come over. I'm like, I thought you just said F the police. I thought you didn't like them. And now you're asking for their help. I mean, it's that's what you see every time when we go to these places. You know, they say they want to stop hating their state. They want to stop violence, but they're the ones who initiate it every time. They're the ones who start it, and then they want to play victim afterwards. And that's what these social justice warriors are professional victims.
It's pretty wild. So we're about to go to break. Any last words?
You know, we're going to continue following these events as they unfold. And whenever we see people acting out of control, we're going to do reports on it and expose these people so people know who the real, patriots are and who the real traitors are.
Cool. All right. Well, thanks, Joe. Appreciate it. We're going to come back and talk about a lot more news and premiere the report about the EU government ID cards to use the internet. It's the fourth hour. We'll be right back. Right, it's the Alex Jones Show. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. What we're going to do is we're going to play this video here in a moment. Yesterday on the show, Alex brought on Kit Daniels, one of his writers for Infowars.com. And this article headline is totally insane, but it's actually, we're going to show you the evidence here. EU proposes government ID to use internet. The European Union is proposing a government ID for using the internet, which will eradicate both online privacy and free speech. Spearheaded by the former communist official Andrus Ansip, the European Commission published a draft document outlining its proposed electronic ID that would not only allow the EU to track what you say online, but also what you buy. And then it links to the document. So we're going to play that here in just a second. Darren McBreen went in and chopped up the interview and showed all the information and everything like that. Very, very useful video. But before that, I want to talk about how I got screwed because, as Alex said before, I went and bought a bunch of different air filters for my house. And like he said, they're very expensive. And what happened was, after about 6 months, they got all clogged up. And I was changing them routinely, everything. But the internal mechanism is just covered in lint and it just doesn't work. When I turn it on, it kind of like spits out lint and stuff like that. And when I heard about the Alexa Pure Pro, I looked it up and I was upset because I spent all this money on these other air filters that were way more money, like 500 plus, and this one is only 100 something. So go to InfoWarsStore.com and check it out, the Alexa Pure Pro air filtration system. Get the exact name here. It's the Alexa Pure Breeze, energy efficient HEPA plus ion cluster air purification system. So I've got these running now in my place. 4-stage purification process. It's patented technology. It's the real deal. So check it out. It's on InfoWarsStore.com. And we clean the outside of our bodies, but why don't we clean the inside? If you go outside and you get all muddy and disgusting, what do you do? You take a shower. If you are cooking and your hands are covered in food and raw meat, you wash your hands. So why don't we clean the inside of our bodies? There is junk in your house. The EPA says 6 out of 10 homes in the United States are sick, buildings. Most pollutants are inside, not outside. So if you feel like crap, maybe it's time to clean your body. Lung Cleanse is an awesome product. It's not talked about enough. There's not enough specials on it because it's hard to supply. It's organic ingredients. They're the real deal. Dr. Group goes out and spends a unquantifiably insane amount of time sourcing this kind of stuff. And Lung Cleanse is the real deal. It's 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, check out the other products there. Spray it in your mouth. Inhale. Clean out your lungs. It's way to go. Clean your inside of your body, too. Now I want to go to this video. EU proposes government ID to use internet. Let's go ahead.
EU proposes government ID to use the internet. Done, done, done. Infowars.com, PrisonPlanet.com. And here is the document. European Commission, COM 2016-288/2, communication from the Commission. And by the way, the unelected Commission does the laws. The Parliament is ceremonial and advisory. Wow, this is a dictatorship. The Commission has spoken. A self-appointed commission that commands through the barrel of a 7.6239 round. And you ask, why are they doing it now? Because they're getting ready to implode the economy and launch big wars and try to start race wars and sectarian wars. I mean, they have got a blueprint. I mean, you can feel it in your gut. But I've gone from, in my spider sense, my sixth sense, my discernment, my spirit, from being, oh, get ready, God, to like now just feeling energized, because now I can tell the lights on, folks. Any fears that I was ever misleading anybody and was ever exaggerating have just peeled back, and my confidence has spiked even more, because unfortunately I know we are in an epic battle, because when they shut down the free speech, they're coming for everything, and these people are bloodthirsty. Look what they do to Christians everywhere they're in control. Kit Daniels, InfoWars.com report. I want to say good job getting this out there. I know this just came out like a day ago, but I mean, where is this? Well, I mean, I don't want to be the one ringing the alarm most of the time up front. That is not a good feeling, you know, to use a Vietnam analogy where they just say for, you know, year after year, you're going to walk in the front every day. I'm like, hey, how about somebody else? Oh, good, somebody else wants to be in the front today. It's not that I'm a coward. It just doesn't seem like good luck. Kit Daniels.
This is exactly it. This is neo-feudalism. This is a way to tax and control the internet. They don't want Matt Drudge with influence, you know, giving the spreading ideas of liberty on the internet. They don't want Alex.
Federal Elections Commission came out and said go after Drudge last week. See, they're all exactly.
They want to turn the internet back into what television was like in the 1960s, where they only had a handful of stations and they controlled everything.
And I've not even stated, so I'm mad at myself, kid. I haven't stated how big this is, and I've always said this forever. When they come out with the internet ID, that's to restrict you, to rate you, to ban you, to track you, to tax you. This is the end of the internet as we know.
I mean, think about it this way. Facebook and Twitter's already 1/3 of the internet. Where's all the internet traffic's going? It's going straight to Facebook. That's just like a TV station in the 1960s that they control, where they can control the narrative. They can control what's spread. They use PC suppression to
exactly.
You know, to destroy any competition to the government.
They're narrative. Carving up the web now. Go over your article. I mean, you've got the subsections. This is devastatingly evil.
Yeah. One thing I brought to that really bothered me about this document is the fact that they're using, that says, the proliferation of online video sharing platforms of content that is harmful to minors and of hate speech. Yeah, but like,
they're going to mix soft porn, but they're going to leave all the big Viacom and Sony women shaking their rear ends. You know, and bikinis, that's okay, but absolutely, they're going to mix political speech in with porn and ban us. They admit it.
Yeah, but like I said on Monday, the EU is the ones that are deciding what is hate speech. And to them, hate speech is just anything that...
An unelected group of admitted communists and socialists working for above-the-law megabanks.
Yeah, anything that runs contrary to their agenda is hate speech to them.
You're not allowed to criticize the migrants raping women or they come arrest you.
Yeah. Or even if you want to spread, say, Austrian economics online, that's hate speech to them.
Drudge is right. They first are putting us into internet ghettos, mm-hmm. And then after you're in a ghetto and dehumanized and made poor and everybody forgets about you and segregated, then you're moved to the electronic concentration camp. So now they're moving to the... I'm not kidding, folks. I mean, we're in a mayday emergency situation.
Yeah, on Monday, I believe, when I saw this article on Drudge, when I woke up in the morning, this Bloomberg article, but what really bothered me about it was how bad they downplayed it.
Oh, they sell it like, exactly, it's real. Oh, we're going to... You know, anything cultural, racial, or religious, we're sorry. You're just going to be banned. Sorry.
And it's like, oh, yeah, well, we're going to just make more censorship. You know,
and oh, the tech companies all just announced in the last 24 hours they're going to sign an agreement with the EU to let them direct. Oh, and Facebook already beta tested hiring former Stasi commanders. It's all seamless integration. They're merging the tech giants with the global government. The Asia-Pacific Union, through the TPP, merges the Atlantic Union, which is the NAU, North American Union, and the European Union. They are merging the three super states with the 10 sub-regions now, with 10 sub-regions per region, directly out of Revelations.
Yeah, what's really bizarre to me is the one world government they're pushing is an electronic super state. I mean, think about it this way. You said this on the broadcast a couple of weeks ago about how Facebook is transforming our culture. You no longer see national identities or culture because everyone's going on Facebook. So now you have what they call a global culture.
Folks, I cannot put a bad enough face on this, but we need a bad face on it to wake up to it, to overthrow the facade in our own minds and realize we are being overtaken by a group of psychopaths that are building an artificial reality to insert us into it so that we're anesthetized and culturally numbed when we're put through the shredder. That's going to be done incrementally. But the final group will be the elites not controlled by the globalists. And you will wish later you would have joined me in the fight against these people. You've got the know-how, the capacity, you know I'm telling the truth, but you don't have enough faith in humanity to make a stand. You'd rather go play golf and go have sex with your mistress and, you know, go do whatever it is and just hope everything's okay. It's not going to be okay. Be a man. Be a woman. Stand up. Speak out. Do something.
There you go. That is the report from EU proposes government ID to use internet. Pretty insane stuff, and hopefully that will get pushed back. It is a proposal, so time to raise some alarm. Now, Bloomberg put out something today that is actually really, really great. And I think we can pull it up on screen because I had to print out a screenshot. It's the Fed's secret liquidity lifelines. And I've talked about before here, when I'm invited to guest host on this show, about the billions of dollars that we, I thought it was billions, that we give banks and taxpayer funding. They make, I think it was $183 billion a year in taxpayer funding that goes towards their profit centers, or $83 billion. Anyway, so... now we have some new information from Bloomberg. Again, this is from Bloomberg. The Fed's secret liquidity lifelines. And it says, the U.S. Federal Reserve mounted an unprecedented campaign to head off a depression by providing as much as 1.2, not billion, trillion in public money to banks and other companies from August 2007 through April 2010. The emergency loans were intended to help recipients cope with cash shortfalls and keep credit markets from grinding to a halt. Bloomberg News sorted through more than 29,000 pages of previously secret documents and Fed spreadsheets detailing more than 21,000 loans to compile a database showing which companies got the emergency liquidity and when. So this is just even what they found. And they found $1 trillion in taxpayer money sent to these banks, corporations. So some of these include Morgan Stanley, which looks to be at about $110 billion, Citigroup, about $100 billion, Bank of America, Royal Bank of Scotland, State Street Corp., Goldman Sachs, J.P. Morgan, Barclays, Merrill Lynch, the usual. Now, what's amazing here is that I'm not against business. I'm not against growth. I'm not against good businesses, even corporations that have made some mistakes. But if they're overall heading in the right direction, if it's overall not completely corrupt, I would love a $1 billion company to do good things in the world. I would love to support a company that's huge. I'm not one of those people that just because it's a corporation, it's evil. I'm just against corporations that want to do us harm for profits or want to loot and destroy the system for profits. And unfortunately, if you've done any research into this, the $1.2 trillion wasn't just to help resuscitate the economy from a little lapse. Even the movie The Big Short did a pretty good job of showing a very, very small fraction of what went on. Nobody went to jail that was actually doing anything. They just looted the entire system. The guys at the top just took as much money as they can. It's almost like they let the fruit grow from the tree of the economy. Like, our economy is just a big tree, and they let the succulent apples grow. And as soon as it's slightly able to be eaten, they just rip the whole all the fruit off the tree. They just rip the tree dry. They just go around picking all the apples and eating them until they throw up and vomit everywhere. When other people are standing around saying, hey, give me some fruit. And I'm not promoting communism or socialism. I'm against the deep corruption of the bank systems that are getting $1.2 trillion, not to resuscitate the economy. It's because they looted it and destroyed it. And then they get money as reprimandation. Oh, here you go. Here's I can't even say it, apparently. It's $1.2 trillion from us, from me, from you, to these companies, these banks. And the companies don't even pay taxes. It's all a big joke. And I'm for business. I'm an entrepreneur. I love growth. But that is a big joke. So I wanted to update you on that. It's not billions. Here's a story that caught my eye as well. So you've heard about the oceans basically being flooded with BPA plastics and the little nanoplastics and everything and the total insanity that's going on. Fish eat plastic like teens eat fast food, researchers say. This is from BBC. Young fish become hooked on eating plastic in the seas in the same way that teenagers prefer unhealthy fast food, Swedish researchers have said. Their study reported in Science found exposure to high concentrations of polystyrene makes perch larvae favor the particles over more natural foods. So the fish are now swimming around on a binge for plastic. They've been completely rewired. They now want to eat the plastic that is killing them and destroying them and destroying sea life. They want to eat the plastic. And there's a picture pulled on screen of its digestive system, this little fish larva. It's got all these little plastic balls in its intestines, where there should obviously be real food. As a result of the exposure to plastic, the young perch are smaller, slower, and more susceptible to predators. The researchers called for plastic microbeads to be banned in cosmetics. It's amazing they're not. But it's so exfoliating. It exfoliates me better. Concerns have been growing about the amount of plastic in the seas in recent years. A study that came out last year estimated that about 8 million tons of plastic waste enters the oceans annually. When exposed to UV radiation, chemical degradation, and the movement of the waves, this plastic breaks down into tiny pieces. Those smaller than 5 millimeters are referred to as microplastics. The term also covers plastic microbeads for personal care products. Scientists have been worried that these tiny fragments can build up in the guts of marine creatures and they can leach toxic chemicals. Oh, yeah, like the toxic chemicals are leaching to us, too. Like when you drink that water bottle that has been sitting in a warehouse that's 90 degrees for 2 months before it was shipped out to the center that it's now being sold from, whether it's a Walmart, HEB, Whole Foods, whatever, and it's nice and crisp and cold. Have you ever drank a water bottle and tasted the stinging plastic taste that you get? I can't even drink it. I'd rather be dehydrated. It tastes like I am drinking molten plastic. And the fish are being destroyed by this. They're being hormonally wrecked. The estrogen mimickers in the plastic, the BPA plastic, who's, by the way, Dr. Group's father is the one that has one of the patents responsible for that. He worked with Exxon, I believe it was. It's an amazing story. And that's how Dr. Group got into all this, because his dad started to realize it was bad for you, and they chose the very plastic that has the BPA in it because, oh, you got to save money, right, instead of the good plastics. So no one is doing anything about it. In the FDA or anything, they looked at it, they reviewed it, they said, oh, it's harmful to kids, it could be harmful, but we're going to keep doing it anyway. There's 180 studies, if I recall correctly, that link BPA to breast cancer. Susan G. Komen for The Cure would rather push Kentucky Fried Chicken bowls. I don't know, maybe we could pull that up. Sorry, I keep making you guys pull up this stuff, but look up Susan G. Komen KFC breast cancer bowls. They had Kentucky Fried Chicken bowls, pink bowls of fried chicken. You can't make this stuff up. And they sold that for breast cancer awareness, Susan G. Komen. And I challenged them. I said, please talk about BPA. I wrote an article about it. I had like 50,000 shares on Facebook. Please talk about the BPA, the bisphenol A, and the BPS that's causing cancer. It's on screen. Fried chicken for the cure, question mark, asks ABC News. Yeah, they did that. They did pink buckets of fried chicken for the cure, which probably contained BPA. But they won't acknowledge BPA. You know, it's good. It's killing the fish, and you're getting it in your water bottle. The answer, by the way, is just either get a water filtration system or drink out of glass. Or go to Whole Foods and buy the huge, huge thing of double distilled or reverse osmosis water. It's like a dollar. It's very, very cheap. You can get well water. There's a million things you could do, but there's no reason to be drinking what tastes like molten plastic when you put it up to your lips. It's totally insane. Anyway, I'll be back with the next segment. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. This is the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show. More to come. More news. So, alienation is killing Americans and Japanese, is what this article says from Nautilus. And this is another good one. We just talked about fish eating plastic because they're addicted to it, like fast food, junk food. I also want to remind you, InfoWarsStore.com, get 20% off lung cleanse, spray it in your mouth, inhale, clean your inside of your body, clean the outside, right? And also the new air filter, the Alexa Pure Breeze. It's right here. It's 26% off for initial launch. It's the real deal. A lot of these units are way, way more expensive. Trust me, I bought them. As I talked about earlier, I've had some in my house that I spent a lot of money on, and they just break, and they're disgusting, and it's impossible to clean. You clean it over and over again, and then the actual unit itself gets clogged up, and you just have to throw it out in the trash. It's a very, very sad thing, throwing out a $500-plus unit after 6 months. But alienation is killing Americans and Japanese. Here's why this is so interesting. So it says, the stories have become all too familiar in Japan, though people often do their best to ignore them. An elderly or middle-aged person, usually a man, is found dead at a home or in his apartment, frequently right in his bed. It has been days, weeks, or even months since he has had contact with another human being. Often the discovery is made by a landlord frustrated at not receiving a rent payment or a neighbor who notices an unpleasant smell. Very disturbing thought. But what it's alluding to, and this is an extensive article, I'm not going to read it all here, is the pandemic, the crisis of losing our connection with other human beings. It could be blamed on a million things, right? It could be blamed on the screen that we all communicate from, such as how I'm potentially communicating to you right now. The screen that we text others on and then meet them in person, it's weird. You ever notice when you are talking to a friend of yours on text for months before you see them again, it's almost weird. It's like a different reality. Well, there could be a million reasons. And I love technology and what it can do. I even love social media and what it can do. But we as a species are losing connection with others. Humanity is becoming very, very singular in many ways, to the point where people are afraid to talk to other people. In this article talking about people dying in their house and no one ever knowing for months because no one goes and sees them or calls them or does anything, it's sad. And you go on the street, and I've been meaning to do a video like this. You go on the street, and you just go up to someone and say, hey, what's up? And they look at you like you're crazy, like you are insane because you actually spoke to them without a direct purpose. Like, if you go to even like a Starbucks, I was at a Starbucks the other day when I was in, it was either New York or Philadelphia, it was in New York City, and I went into Starbucks, and I was buying a water and like a Clif Bar, and I just said, hey, what's up? How are you doing today? And they looked at me like, what? Like, someone's talking to me. You're supposed to just say how much. Swipe the card, take it, put it in the bag, walk away, and you don't talk again. You don't get out of line, because that's weird when you talk to people. Talking to people is weird. How weird? Like, I can't actually have a communication with someone outside of the rules. That is, how much is that? I'm going to go now. Not allowed to talk to people. It is a serious thing. You're going to see in a few years, it's going to get even worse. People are so afraid to communicate with others now. It has gotten absurd. And it's partially to do with the phones, partially to do with technology. Anyway, this has been the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. Always a pleasure to join you guys. Alex will be back Sunday from 4 to 6 p.m. Central Standard Time. Don't miss it. Thanks for watching.